Don Guggerty, joined, of course, by Dan Bolek. We are just about ready to get underway here on what has turned out to be, Dan, a really nice Saturday afternoon here in Fitchburg.
You know, there are clouds in the sky. The sun is just trying to battle through to illuminate the field. But the temperatures are nice and comfortable, about 60 degrees. The wind is calm for the moment. We don't expect it to be as breezy as it was last week. And we're going to have some good football weather here today at Elliott Field.
You know, it's a little bit overcast, a little bit of a chill in the air. You can feel that fall is coming as we are here on, you know, Indigenous Peoples Day weekend on College Football Saturday. And there you see lovely Elliott Field here just off of John Fitch Highway in Fitchburg. Plenty of good seats available, folks, if you are in Fitchburg and feel like coming out and enjoying a football game. And hey, if you want to stay at home, we understand. Your couch is comfy, it's warm, you have your cat or whatever. We'll be here with you for the duration here on FATV. Also, Dan, something we should mention. We've heard, and I may have even heard this from you, the Framingham games are among the most popular games that we do here on FATV in terms of live streaming. You know, a lot of folks from Framingham who don't make the trip, you know, how would you get here from Framingham? Probably 495 to 2, something like that. Maybe take 117, something like that.
Of the shorter trips.
My point is, if you don't feel like coming up from Framingham and you're joining us on FATV.org, thank you so much for being here. We will keep you company for the duration of this one as, once again, the Falcons of Fitchburg State get ready to take on the Rams of Framingham State. You see the Rams taking the field there, Dan. They come in with a record 3-2. They are 3-0, however, in the MASCAC.
Indeed they are. Open the season with losses against strong New York State teams. Brockport 31-0, St. John Fisher 38-7. UMass Dartmouth was the only team in the conference who won both of their non-conference games, but Framingham had no trouble dealing with the Corsairs, took them down 45-21. The last couple of weeks, they have had, you know, you can't decide strength of schedule in advance and what have you, but it's been a weird coincidence that this is going to be the third straight week that Framingham is playing a team that currently sits at no wins.
And they have taken care of business against that lighter portion of their schedule. They had a 41-6 win over Westfield State, a 33-0 win over Plymouth State, and they get ready to take on the Falcons here at Elliott Field. Fitchburg State comes in with a record 0-5. They are 0-3 in the MASCAC. You see the Falcons taking the field there. They'll be wearing their green and gold today. Green jerseys, gold pants. Framingham State, of course, in the white on white with those black or very dark blue. They're black helmets.
They're
right?
Black.
They're black. They do the old Pittsburgh thing, black and yellow, with a lot of white.
There's very little yellow in their jerseys, though, in this particular palette.
That's true.
I mean, they traditionally have used yellow as an accent color, but there's just not a whole lot today. But as you've mentioned, Fitchburg is coming off their second consecutive shutout loss. 42-0 they fell to the Bears on Saturday. The Falcons had to use four quarterbacks in that game out of necessity. We've been told they are all healthy, and we should be seeing Joe Haskins and Logan Wilson fit to play today at the very least. They combined to go 4 of 12 through the air for 28 yards. They ran the ball combined 33 times for 77 yards. Alfred Robinson was actually the best ball carrier of the day for the Falcons. 9 carries for 46 yards. The green and gold did get 207 yards of offense and held Bridgewater to 313 yards. They gave the Bears a lot of great field position, which made things a lot more challenging.
Captains are heading to midfield for the coin toss. Left to right for the Falcons, you see the starting quarterback, Joe Haskins, along with Joel Montero and Makondo Ashima. Captains for Framingham State are Cully Curran, Anthony Bohonek, Jack Canny, and Joshua Onajuwega.
Number 14, Joe Haskins. Number 25, Makondo Ashima.
We are just about ready to get underway here at Elliott Field. Again, it is a lovely day for a football game, so if you're in the area, feel free to come on down. But if not, you know, feel free to stick around as well. We love to have you here. We love to hear your feedback. Looks like the Rams will receive the opening kickoff, so we'll see Framingham State's offense to start the game in just a moment. Dan and I will step aside for the national anthem, but we'll be back momentarily. It's College Football Saturday here on FATV. College Football Saturday here on FATV from Elliott Field in Fitchburg. John Guggerty joined as always by Diesel Dan Bullock. And Dan, why don't we take a moment to thank some of the underwriters that make this and every broadcast possible here on FATV.
Indeed, our underwriters for today's game are Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise.
Okay, so there are two healths there.
Yes.
UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance Clinton Hospital.
Correct.
Okay, I'm going to fist bump Freddie, and then we'll talk about football. Hey, Freddie, give me a fist bump. Have a good game, man. One of the benefits of being up in the stands is the mascot's just kind of walking around. We can be a little bit more biased. Just a little bit. And our grounds for
removal from the site of. Have you ever broadcast a game in which the mascot is standing right behind you, listening to every word you say?
That sounds creepy.
I've done that before, though.
I mean, we've seen the mascots, you know, come into the press box every now and then for water or something, but the whole game just watching you? Oh, God, imagine if it was Gritty. Oh, now I'm. Every time I turn to my left, I'm going to think Gritty's behind me. You scared me, Dan.
Oopsie.
All right, well, we are just about set for the opening kickoff here from Elliott Field. And here with the play-by-play for the first quarter is Dan Bolak.
Thank you very much. As they're going to go with the quick onside kick. This worked last week for their one kickoff. Ball is still loose. And has Fitchburg gotten on top of it?
The Falcons have the ball. Well, swear jar. But the Falcons recover the onside kick. It took a wild bounce through the hands of one of the upmen for the Rams. Dan, the Falcons were not especially subtle about their intentions there. It was, you know, looked pretty clear that they were thinking of doing something.
You know, last week down 28-0 for their kickoff, they onside kicked it. And they got that to work. This time, Matt Kimball, you know, a little stronger on the leg, but it hops over the upman for Framingham, not expecting it, makes its way well downfield, and Fitchburg will have the ball to start both halves in this contest as it stands, because as we know, that didn't happen last week either.
Fitchburg didn't get the ball to start either half last week. You know, perhaps the great cosmic scales are now even.
Anderson LaRosselier.
And thinking last night, the Fitchburg State game, the Fitchburg High game against Marlboro, Fitchburg kicked off to start, and they recovered the kickoff then, too. This is something we've seen quite frequently, it seems, in the last week in this Fitchburg area.
First down play call for the Falcons was a handoff straight up the middle to Frank Sims. Didn't get much. It'll be second down and 9 for Fitchburg State.
Aguirre goes in motion. Haskins wants to throw. He's lost the football. Falcons are able to recover it.
The officials are calling that an incomplete pass. It looked to the naked eye, Dan, like that was the correct call. Haskins was rearing back and he was getting ready. He was putting his arm forward to send that ball deep.
From the looks of it, from what I saw, I thought it just sort of fell right out of his hand as he took contact. I'd say a little fortunate that, you know, they blew the play dead, called it an incomplete pass. The Falcons will take that. I mean, if it was a fumble and it was a recovery there, it would have been a loss of yardage. So
hey, you know, you see Dave Douglas, the umpire there. When Dave Douglas is on the field, you're going to get a well-officiated football game. That's what happens.
Palazzo will swing out to the left side. Haskins under a bit of pressure as the line starts to collapse. He makes his way to the near sideline and eventually run out of bounds at the 34-yard line. He got back to the line. The original line to gain, or the original marker to start the drive. And so the onside kick, not coming to much of anything, and the Falcons, this is a little rough that they're looking to punt here.
I mean, it's 4th and 10, you've had 3 plays and you've gained exactly 0 yards, so I can understand the decision to punt here.
It's just going to come down to trying to pin the Rams deep, trying to cough and corner. It looked like they can get that bounce. And
the officials are going to spot it at the 1 yard line. Ball was picked up on the run and then kind of taken into the end zone. But I think what they're saying, Dan, is the Fitchburg defender who I believe.
That was D. Jones.
That was, in fact, D. Jones. I thought it was. So D. Jones ran down, picked up the ball, and he possessed it for like a good solid second, just kind of tiptoeing on the 1 yard line, and then he went into the end zone. So once he actually grabbed possession of the ball became dead right there at the 1 yard line. Yep. It's a fantastic punt by Haskins.
Yep. They spot it inside the one, essentially. So the Rams backed up as far as they can go. A quick pass on first down to get themselves some breathing room, as
making the completion is E.J. Nichols
for his 31st catch of the season, the sophomore from Burlington Township, New Jersey.
And how about this, Dan? First and 10 for Framingham State. First offensive play of the game. You're at your own 1 yard line, and you go gun empty, five wide. How about that?
Looks so ambitious, but they have the confidence to make that work. Nicholas Gifredo, the quarterback for the Rams. His pass is incomplete to Nick Gordon, who was looking for his third catch of the season.
Pass was just a little bit out of the reach of Gordon that time. He went down to a slide, tried to get it, but it was just a bit beyond his reach.
75 completions for these Rams quarterbacks this season. E.J. Nichols has 31 of them. So you can see that's the most obvious target out there. So it'll go second and 10. Gifredo looks to his left. Gets that off, and that is Nichols again. He makes the completion, stays inbounds to the 25, and it'll be another first down for the Rams.
I assume it's not a coincidence that the man named Nichols is wearing number 5. That's too good not to be intentional, right?
Rams first and 10 from their own 26.
I suppose if he's Nichols, he should be wearing 55, but that's not really an eligible receiver type number, is it?
Yeah, the NCAA don't like that.
Yeah, no, but 5's good. 5's good.
Best you can do after that.
3 ain't enough. He wants 5.
Or maybe it should be 2 or, you know, some other multiple of 5, because Nichols should be plural, right? Here's the first run attempt of the day. It's going to be Devon Ford going up the middle. He's going to be probably taking the bulk of the carries for the Rams today. He'll get it to the 29-yard line, a gain of 3.
Just over 250 yards and 3 touchdowns already on the season for Devon Ford, the sophomore from Mashpee.
Andrew Whittingham.
This time he runs into a whole flock of Falcons. But picks up 3 yards. Good second effort there as he just kind of pulled the pile forward while they dragged him down.
Ford is also third on the team this season in completions. Gifredo looks right side. Nichols for his third catch. He gets out of the tackle there and makes his way down the far side, still in bounds. Walking the tightrope until he finally steps out past midfield. And it'll be another first down for the Rams.
Framingham State's offense so far, Dan, has been as advertised. They are getting the ball in the hands of E.J. Nichols. This time, just great work by the Ram offensive line, giving their quarterback, Gifredo, plenty of time to stand in the pocket, find Nichols. You know, it's on Nichols to get into the open field. And he does that, then a wonderful second effort, tiptoes along the sideline there. And he's finally run out of bounds across midfield into Falcon territory.
Rams trying to open the scoring with a 99-yard drive. They're already halfway there. And on first down, Bookie McBean Jr., who is, of course, a junior as well, gets himself over 250 yards on the season on the ground with that carry.
McBean's been kind of a change of pace back for Framingham State so far this season. Ford had, you know, 66 carries. McBean only had about 50. But their yardage is almost identical. McBean's averaging a full yard more per carry than Devon Ford here on the season.
He's also got the longest run on the campaign, 34 yards. This will bring up second down for the black and gold. Gifredo looks left side, another completion. And he'll be wrestled down. It's Isaiah Hanks, who is second on the team in receptions coming into today.
You know, I'm sure it's one of their primary colors, Dan, but really, are they the black and gold today? These are the black and white. These guys are playing politics in black and white.
They're playing in grayscale today.
Bet you didn't expect the Barnum reference here 5 minutes into a, not less than 5 minutes into a football game. But, you know, you got to keep the people on their toes. Yep.
10:20 to go. First quarter, no score. The Rams starting to threaten here. It's Gifredo with plenty of time to pass, looking for the home run ball. There's the first incompletion.
Oh.
Or is that the second incompletion of the day? It would be. Yes, second. As he wanted the home run pass to Nichols, his favorite target, but it was too far away even for him.
Both of the incompletions from Gifredo have just been on, you know, a little bit of an overthrow. And honestly, when you're throwing the deep ball, you want to overthrow it as opposed to underthrowing it. Gifredo put that ball in a position where if anyone was going to catch it, it was going to be his receiver Nichols, and EJ just couldn't run under it.
Gifredo, junior from Hyde Park, played at Catholic Memorial, throw over the middle, and that one's going to be caught. Isaiah Hanks again.
Pass is complete to Isaiah Hanks.
More yardage for the Rams. Brings it to the 20-yard line.
Jones with the Pittsburgh hit.
Hanks has four touchdowns through the air on the year.
The Pittsburgh 19.
That's actually more than Nichols, who only has one. But the Rams continuing to make progress. The visiting FSU into the red zone now. McBean to the right of Gofredo as Devon Ford now joins him in the backfield on the other side, and he'll take the handoff as he tries to find a hole on the right side. Gets all the way out to the flank, gets out of a tackle, and gets his way to the 10-yard line. Devon Ford just kept on moving.
First down yardage on the game.
And it'll move the chains yet again.
The running game hasn't been a major factor for Framingham State on this first drive, Dan. It's been a lot of yardage through the air, but this time Devon Ford, as you said, just did a good job following his blocks, finding the hole. He stayed on his feet for a long time there. He was able to dance his way forward for about 10 yards and a Framingham first down.
164 yards a game of passing offense, 157 yards a game of rushing offense. Just the box man on the crew that has to do work now as they're inside the 10. Get two in the backfield. Gofredo thinking, gonna go with the dump off pass to Ford. He is open. He's gonna make his way inside the 5.
Gofredo to Ford.
Falcon defense kind of sitting back there, making sure they had the receivers in the end zone
cover.
But of course, with it being first and goal, Framingham State has the luxury, and Gofredo has the wisdom to know, hey, if I can dump it off and get 3-4 yards here, it's a good play on first and goal. You know, this time he gets about 4 there, it'll be second and goal from the 5.
Gofredo 6 of 8 for 74 yards on this drive, 8:35 to go in the first. And the Rams knock it on the door. Gofredo, quick throw, left side, incomplete. It was actually tipped up in the air by Marcus Moss.
Ball's incomplete. Gordon, the intended receiver. There are late.
And there is a flag coming in at the very end. Our first penalty of the day.
Flags are back toward the line of scrimmage as opposed to in the coverage area, so I don't think it's anything on Moss for the way he was covering the receiver there. But Framingham's offensive line is not terribly happy. We'll see what the call is.
Get ball. Sportsmanlike conduct, number 25 of the defense. Half the distance to the goal, automatic first down. That is number 25's first UNS of the game.
So Makondo Ashima did something unsporting and have given the Rams a fresh set of downs and a couple free yards.
Yeah, the yards don't really matter there, Dan, but it's a huge mental error. Sets up first and goal again. Fitchburg State had a chance to maybe stop Framingham on third and hold them to a field goal try here, but instead a fresh set for the Rams.
Going right to the end zone, battling with D. Jones. But Jones comes up the victor in that one. One of the interesting things I noticed during last week's game against Bridgewater is that Bridgewater seemed allergic to the idea of throwing in D. Jones' direction.
Yeah, we barely called his name at all. Jones has been a standout for the Falcon defense.
He's a hometown kid as well, Fitchburg High grad.
He's just a freshman.
Indeed. So second down, it's gonna be Devon Ford trying to make his way across the goal line. He's done that. 99 yard drive for the Rams and a touchdown to open the scoring.
3 yard touchdown rush, Devon Ford.
It's gotta be so disheartening for a defense. Your special teams does pretty much as it can possibly do, punting the ball inside the 1 yard line. Framingham State just takes it and says, oh, we need to get 99 yards? Okay. And then they get 99 yards.
Extra point is up and it is good off the foot of Matthew Farley. He stands 17 for 17 on the campaign. 8:12 to go, first quarter, and Framingham has the first strike.
You know, Dan, we were talking about how D. Jones is a freshman and potentially a longtime member of the Falcon defense. There are a lot of underclassmen on this Rams roster. They have a very big roster, but there are very few seniors and juniors.
Two graduate students, 5 seniors, 11 juniors, 25 sophomores, and 47 freshmen. A very young Framingham State roster, but you know, The Rams did a great job of recruiting the last couple of years. Ansley Rosenbaum, who had become the head coach briefly, but now Tom Kelly stepping back in command of this Rams side. You know, they've done a lot of work recruiting, but also just the fact that Framingham has been a power in the MASCAC for such a long time. They come into this game having won 15 MASCAC games in a row and having won 11 meetings in a row with Fitchburg State. You have to go back to 2008 to find the last time the Falcons beat the Rams. The Rams had 8 first downs on that drive, 97 yards, because, you know, the 2 penalty yards at the end, and did not face third down during that drive either. Would have if not for the penalty. As on the return, we'll bring it to about the 20-yard line. I think that was Dickerson.
Well, I was going to look at his number, but, well.
Dickerson.
Yeah, Dickerson. It was Dickerson.
Dylan DeWolf had the hit for the Rams.
There we go. There's a better look at it.
So Dickerson goes to bring that in, and, you know, just the coverage collapses around him at the 20. Can't get any farther than that. Always remember, if you are a kick returner, you do have the option to take a fair catch inside the 25, and they'll give you the 25.
That's a good thing to know.
If you really don't feel too comfortable with the kick returning, that is something that you can do on kickoffs. On first down, it's going to be Frank Sims going up the middle. You get a good few yards out of that.
Sims the ball carrier.
Looks like he'll get to about just short of the 25.
Falcon offense was unable to get basically anything going on their first drive. They had the run up the middle that was stuffed, the incomplete pass on what could have been a fumble, and then Haskins just scrambled out of bounds.
They were officially given 3 plays for no yards on that first drive.
Second and 6.
Sounds about right. But the first down carry got 4, so it'll be second down and 6 now for the Falcons.
We just passed halfway in this first quarter. Aguirre takes a sidestep in motion. Ultimately, it's another carry to Sims, trying to go up the middle. He'll get the 25, but it's going to bring up a third and about 6.
Anderson Larosillier was one of the many Rams on that defensive line who burst through. He was the first guy there. Just wrapped up Sims, dragged him backwards. Had a couple guys jump on top for good measure. Dan, this running game for Fitchburg State, it's been a struggle all season. An offensive line, you know, a little young, a little undersized, and a lot depleted by injury. It's been hard to get anything going.
135 yards a game, the Falcons average on the ground. The passing game, worse than that. Haskins trying to run to the left side, maybe a delayed option pitch if he thought there would be an opening. There never was. A flag comes in at the very end here.
There is a late flag.
I think that was an option play, Dan. He had Ben Palaszczuk running behind him, did Haskins. See an official there right in the middle of the screen, just kind of exchanging, let's hope they're pleasant words, with Tashay Johnson Jr., one of the corners for Framingham State.
First ball, number 80 of the offense. 15-yard penalty. It'll be fourth down.
Marvin Jean-Baptiste called for the personal foul. Already the second penalty against Fitchburg, both of the unsporting variant. I'll back them up half the distance. So the offense spinning their wheels on the first two drives, and now we'll see if the defense, well, after the punt, we'll see what we have from there.
See if we can maybe see what happened. Jean-Baptiste is at the top of the screen. He gets pushed down, and I bet you the officials are going to get him for retaliation. Yep, right there. Jean-Baptiste got pushed down, and then as he was retaliating, grabbing the leg of the guy who pushed him down, that's what they called.
And more whistles.
I heard somebody shout false start.
False start, 22 offense. 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Devin Current called for the jump, and everyone's got to take a few steps back.
Dan, Fitchburg's offense has not been content with their inability to go forward and have instead chosen to go backward. It's a bold plan. I don't know if it'll work, but it's new.
The offense 6 plays for 6 yards, and the penalty yards just adding unpleasantness to the whole thing. Haskins gets a high punt in the air. He'll take a hop towards the sidelines and go out of bounds, just short of the 40.
Offense back to the field. First and 10.
So it'll be a very short field for the Rams. to try to answer back with 5:52 to go in the first.
Well, we've seen that Framingham State doesn't really care about being pinned deep in their own territory. I still kind of can't get over the fact, Dan, on their first play from scrimmage, with their backs against their goal line, first and 10 on your own one, shotgun empty backfield, five receivers.
Yeah, they basically just telling, yeah, we're going to pass it. Can you stop us? We don't think you can.
And they were right. That play got, you know, 10, 15 yards. Drive got 99.
On first down, it is Gofredo. He's got some pressure here. He's going to be taken down for a sack.
Gofredo is sacked.
Makanu Ashima takes down Gofredo. And there is something encouraging for Fitchburg.
Measure of revenge for Ashima after the personal foul gave Framingham a fresh set of downs inside the two on their last drive. This time he comes pretty much unblocked from the offensive left side. You see Gofredo pump to his left, realize, oh crap, I gotta get out of here. He tries to take off, but it's too late. Ashima's faster than him. It's a loss of about 8 yards.
Second and 19 now, under pressure again. That was a hurried throw that ultimately follows incomplete to Kareem Coleman. But yeah, the Falcons on that one did pretty well to get past the Rams line. For the first time today, Framingham's going to face third down.
Fitchburg State brought the heat again. This time it was Devin Current coming unblocked from the right side. Gofredo had to get rid of that one pretty much right when he did. If he didn't, he was going to go down again.
Ashima picking up his first full sack of the season a couple plays ago, had a half. Just do a quick dump off pass to Nichols, hope he can get all those yards after the catch. He's gonna get a good chunk of those yards after the catch and will be pretty close to a first down. He's not gonna have the first down, but it's gonna make fourth down a little more interesting.
I think they should go for it, Dan. You know, I think this was the design all along for Framingham State. You know, it's third and 18. You don't have many plays in the playbook that are designed to get you 18 yards. But if you toss it out to the far side here, get it in the hands of your best receiver, E.J. Nichols, see what he can do with the ball. Like, if he doesn't get anything, you shrug your shoulders and punt. If this happens, where he makes some guys miss and he picks up 15 yards, it's fourth and four and you go for it.
Indeed they will. But a flag on the snap, basically.
Full spare. Number 40 offense, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Bookie McBean guilty of a key false start. Dan, if I'm Fitchburg State's coaching staff, if I'm Scott Sperone, I am telling D. Jones, I'm going up to D. Jones and I'm saying, D, this is your job. Find number five and cover him. That is your job for the entire game. That is what you are doing. I don't care what the play call is. You find number five and you cover him.
Dickerson set deep to the foul.
We've already seen D. Jones play some strong defense up against E.J. Nichols. It's absolutely within the realm of feasibility. Henrik Deboni had the punt, and that's not as good of a one as we would have expected.
Punt goes out of bounds.
That was there was a gust of wind, I think, right as Deboni released the ball and got ready to drive his leg through it, and just kind of squirted off to the left side there.
Yep.
That's like a 15-yard punt?
It's not a good one. Deboni came into this game, you know, he punted three times this season, 46.3-yard average. All three of them pinned him inside the 20. Didn't pin him inside the 20 that time. Looks like they'll start from the 28.
Falcons first and 10 from their own 29.
Well, that happens to everybody.
Hey, you know.
First down, right up the middle, and a hole did open up there for Frank Sims, who was able to get a healthy five.
Gain of about six on the play.
Falcons keep sending Ben Palaszczuk in motion here, indicating that they might want to go with a toss or a jet sweep or something. And on this play, they decide once again to hand it off to Sims up the middle. This one actually gets a pretty good gain. It'll be second down and four.
Falcons operating out of that flex bone offense. Alizé again, the man in motion. They'll go to Sims again. Not gonna let him have it that easily that time. He'll get at most back to the line of scrimmage.
Ball came out after the play, but it was well after Sims was down.
Short gain on the play.
The Falcons tied for third worst in Division III in terms of fumbles lost, eight this season. However, five of those were in one game.
You know that doesn't make it better.
Third and three.
does mean in most of the other games they're good at securing the football.
I suppose you have a point.
So the Falcons were unsuccessful on their last two third down conversion attempts. See if they can find success this time as Aguirre goes in motion and they try to go with the quick handoff to Sims again. And again, the Rams really not letting the Falcons get anything more on the ground after that one error, if you will, that gave him seven. Not going to let him get any more than that.
You know, there really hasn't been any variety in the play calling from Fitchburg State. You know, it's just been handed off to Sims straight up the middle. This time, Sims ran right into the arms of Anthony Bohonic, one of the few upperclassmen, actually a graduate student from Rutland.
So now on fourth down, Falcons will go for it. You can see Framingham stacking the box deeply. Gonna make it a battle in the trenches. See if Fitchburg did enough to push the pile forward.
That was a long yard that Fitchburg needed. They go with the quarterback sneak. Framingham State is indicating that they didn't get it. Given where the officials are placing the ball, that looks very close. I think it's short, honestly. It was fourth and a long yard. Nope, they're going to move the chains. That's good for a Fitchburg first down.
Hey, that's a first down, Falcons. Falcons first and 10.
So fourth and one, they go with the QB sneak. Haskins was stuffed and then never was not stuffed, and then they somehow gave him an extra yard.
Joe Haskins, the ball carrier.
They gave, you know, they put the ball right on the 39-yard line, and the stick was on the 39. So if they put it, you know, the tail on the 39, they figure that's good enough. And on first down, Haskins on the option keeps it himself and gets a couple. Probably about three. As we've mentioned before, because of the flex bone, because of how they run that, what looks like a minute gain can actually be a couple of yards because you're not starting that far back. So brings up a second down, pitch out to Palazze, see if he can find some room, but the hole closes up quickly as he gets back to the line of scrimmage.
Well, I mentioned, Dan, that they keep sending him in motion. One of these times they're going to have to pitch it out to him. Framingham State was ready for it.
Anthony Bohonic.
We've seen Palazze have some success in the kick return game and as an occasional ball carrier. Nothing doing for him there. Now it'll be third and seven, you know.
About 10-second difference between game and play clock. Haskins has attempted one pass, and that wasn't really a pass attempt either. I would like to see the Falcons try to go through the air, even at this moment. And he's rolling out to the right as if he's going to, and he's going to make the pass, and it goes in and out of the hands of Palazze, who was double covered, but he did get his hands on the football.
Was a high throw, but definitely a catchable one. You know, Palazze kind of snaps down his chin strap in frustration. He feels like he should have caught that ball.
And,
you know, to be honest, I kind of agree with him. That was a pretty catchable pass.
And he knows, you know, that brings, you know, they go for it on fourth down, hoping to keep the momentum going. But again, momentum just not working in the Falcons' favor.
But hey, you know, they actually, you know, rolled out to the right, created some space for their quarterback, got the throw away. Some positives.
Haskins with a line drive punt and ultimately going to be fielded at the 16-yard line by the Rams in Kelvin Davila. And Davila can't really bring it back that far, so it works out pretty well for the Falcons. And pushing and shoving after that, and we'll see if there's any more yards to be added or taken away.
There are going to be some flags here. I think somebody just threw a punch.
Someone very much did just throw a punch. I didn't need my binoculars to tell you that. Some frustration brewing here on this lovely autumn day here in Fitchburg as we reach the end of the first quarter. That's an interesting way to end the frame.
I think we're gonna start the second quarter with one fewer Ram active in this football game than we ended the first. That was a pretty clear blow to the head after the play.
That is the end of the first period. After the play, dead ball and sportsmanlike conduct. Number 5, Framingham State, he is ejected from the game.
That is huge. That is number 5. That is the leading receiver for Framingham State, E.J. Nichols. E.J. Nichols will take no further part in this football game. What was E.J. Nichols even doing on the field there? I guess he was part of the punt return unit. Wow.
That's a tremendous lack of discipline. You know, we mentioned last week, we've had an ejection now in all three of the games we've had here in Fitchburg. And we mentioned, you know, the last two were targeting penalties. And now Nichols wants an explanation. But it was pretty obvious what he'd done, and it wasn't a good thing.
You take your hand, you throw your hand forward in the direction of another gentleman's hat. You hit the gentleman in the hat with your hand. That is a violent physical act.
Nichols waves to the crowd as he comes off the field as well.
The crowd is happy to wave back to it because that is a key member of Framingham State's offense is just not going to take part in the rest of this game.
Yeah, did we not mention that he has a significant percentage of the Rams' completions this season? And we mentioned, you know, with targeting, if you get thrown out of the game, you can stay on the bench the rest of the game and whatever. You just can't participate in the game anymore. But you get thrown out like that, no, you've got to go to the locker room. You are out of sight and sound. You're going to sit in the locker room. You're going to sit on the bus and think about what you did. But for now, E.J. Nichols is happy.
He's going to pull up his phone and go to FATV.org and watch the rest of the game is what he's going to do.
He very much could do that. He was happy to play the heel as he came off the field there.
Oh, very much.
But now it's time for the second quarter of football. And John Gugerty, it's time for you to get to work.
Work, right. All right, first and 10 Framingham State at their own 9-yard line. Handoff goes to the left side, breaking into the second level, bouncing out to the outside, finally spun down. And just short of the 20-yard line is Devon Ford. Ford will probably play a larger part in the rest of this game than maybe Framingham State had intended. The Rams will play the rest of this game without their leading receiver, E.J. Nichols. You know, Dan, it's only a one-score game.
It is.
I'm just saying. But it will be second down and 3-4 Framingham State. High snap. But breaking through is Ford, running right through a tackle before finally being swarmed down. This has been a physical, aggressive game. That time they keep the physicality to the football field.
Look at the replay here, so Gofredo able to pull in the high snap, and Ford as he comes through. There's the stiff arm, you know, he just throws him to the ground there. I like the authority that the Mashpee native is able to show as he runs the ball.
Torian Wise Jr. tried to lower his shoulder and deliver a big hit, but he was the one who got run over. Now back to pass, throw to the left side is low, but it's caught. Spun down after a short gain.
Elijah Hanks, who made that catch there.
Yep.
The junior from Chelsea.
Nice tackle for the Falcons.
Plenty of time for Gofredo. And he's able to get it off to Hanks.
Second and 5.
It's a gain of 5. It'll be second down and 5 for the Rams as they are on the march. Gofredo throws to his left, wide open and caught. Nothing fancy there, just a quick comeback to the far side. Catch made by Kareem Coleman, freshman from Methuen.
I look at these lead receivers for Framingham, and we talked about the youth, and I just see a lot of freshmen and sophomores. Isaiah Hanks is a junior, Shaquille Joseph is a senior, but other than that, a lot of their lead receivers are underclassmen.
And you talk about how there's a flag on the field well after the play, or even maybe before the next play. Thrown into the Fitchburg backfield. Framingham is happy about it. This game is quickly.
Sportsmanlike conduct, number 35 of the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down. That is his first UNS of the game.
Mike Brown guilty of some unprofessional behavior, shall we say.
I don't know why you'd expect any professional behavior at a Division III game.
It's a fair point, but still. Conduct unbecoming a sporting gentleman. How about that?
Sounds good, but it's a free 15 yards for the Rams. And now they're well into Falcon territory.
This game is on the verge of getting out of hand in more ways than one. I think it would be fair to say.
It's chippy.
It's chippy. It's a good word for it. May have advanced beyond chippy already. It got to chippy very quickly. First down handoff goes to Bookie McBean. Bookie goes straight through the middle, runs through one tackle, but can't escape his debtors long enough. He gains about 8 yards. It'll be second and two for the Rams.
Joe Montero had the Pittsburgh hit.
McBean finding the hole up the middle.
Second and two.
Felt like he had to sidestep a little bit out of the umpire, but you know, he's just as much of the part of the play as well.
Hey, you know, Dave Douglas, he's on top. Literally in that case, which maybe you're not supposed to be, but he's good. Second down handoff goes to McBean. Nothing at the line of scrimmage. Actually, excuse me, this is Devon Ford, the ball carrier. Flag comes in on the tackle. Usually not a good sign for the defense.
Might have been in a hand in a place that it didn't belong.
Ford thinks he got grabbed by the face mask.
Personal foul, face mask, 29 of the defense, 15-yard penalty. First down.
Rod Bonhomme guilty of the offense.
The hand very much going where it doesn't belong, right into the grill.
Take a look at it right there. Yep, the right hand of Bonhomme. You know, it's not the traditional face mask. He kind of grabbed him off to the side, right where the mask connects to the helmet. But you still can't grab that metal bar anywhere at all. That's 30 yards of penalties that the Falcons have handed over on this drive alone. First and 10 for the Rams on the very outer edge of the Falcon red zone. Ford comes in motion into the backfield. Back to pass, rolls to his right under pressure. Got to get rid of it, lobs it up. That is caught by Ford. It'll be a first down. There's a flag on the hit. I think there is also a flag in the backfield. I think there are going to be two different fouls on this play. There's also an official without his hat on, indicative that somebody probably went out of bounds at some point. Or it's just windy. It could just be windy.
I'm not going to even try to analyze what happened there until we get the official word on it.
I believe I heard the referee tell Coach Sperone that there is a call for holding. So the flag in the backfield is going to be a hold against the Rams. I don't know what the other one is. It may just be offsetting penalties.
We had two fouls on the play. We had a legal touch. Receiver went out of bounds on the offense, came back in, was first to touch the ball. We had holding offense, 10-yard penalty. That'll be accepted. Still first down.
So both penalties against Framingham State, there was illegal touching. We mentioned the official who was without his hat. That was because a player went out of bounds, came back in. That must have been Ford, who went out of bounds, came back in. Once you do that, you can't be the first guy to touch the ball. And then there's also a hold, which you can see right there. Yeah, no, when the shirt is extended just like that, I'm sorry, you cannot do that, Jackie Canny. I don't care if you're one of the captains. You just can't do it. First down and 20 now for the Rams. Gofredo back to pass, looking to the end zone. That pass is incomplete, just a little bit overthrown. Nothing Nick Gordon could do about it. Was just beyond his reach. There were two Falcons running behind him. Well, a perfect pass would have found his receiver in stride, but it was just a little too long.
I wonder if that's the type of ball E.J. Nichols could have hauled in.
Maybe. You know, we did see Framingham State go deep on their first drive and slightly overthrow it, so.
But in the end, Gofredo is putting it where he should be putting it.
Again, if you're gonna miss with a deep ball like that, miss long. Put a little more on it as opposed to a little less. Second down 20, Gofredo going long again. This one for Ford in the end zone. That is caught, touchdown Rams. Devon Ford with a 30-yard touchdown catch.
Nicholas Gofredo to Devon Ford.
11-11 to play here in the second quarter at Elliott Field, and Framingham State now has a two-score lead.
Of course, with 20 to gain, just go for it all on these passes. And D. Jones battling there with Ford. You know, them coming together with the hands, battling for it. But
was there a little bit of a push off there, Dan? Was I seeing something?
There was a little bit of jostling with the arms.
Just a little bit. Matthew Farley on to attempt the extra point. It is up and good. Farley remains perfect on the season. Now 18 out of 18 for the freshman from Middleborough. Framingham State leads this one 14 to nothing. and it gives us a chance to remind you folks that there is so much to watch on your community access station. Check out quality FATV programs such as Barbara and You, Inside Fitchburg, Chess Chat, Forks Over Fitchburg, and Discussing Fitchburg Now. FATV also, of course, covers many local events, including Memorial Day ceremonies, graduations, local high school, and collegiate sports. That's what you're watching right now. You can watch local government meetings and some of the best local election coverage around, thanks to Flap TV. Visit FATV.org for schedules to access video on demand on your time and view our live streams. Once again, that's FATV.org. Oh, and don't forget to follow FATV on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And you know, I'm on the internet, he's on the radio. We're people in the world. You know, we're out there. You can find us. Ain't that right, Diesel?
Indeed we are.
Okay. So with 11-11 to play here in the second period, Framingham State now leads by two scores, 14-0. This is a high, booming kick taken in at about the four-yard line. Trying to find something, bounces across the 25 before being pushed out of bounds. Not much there, but Dickerson did what he could with it. And you see there, Jordan Dickerson is actually pretty slow to get up right at the Fitchburg sideline, pretty much directly in front of our position here.
As it goes leaping into the air, airborne, and he's tackled while in the air, so it's probably a tough landing for him.
And we'll take a look at it again from our right side end zone camera. Just goes up, gets hit by, gets gored essentially by three Rams right into him. And then he is still slow to get up here on the near sideline. Is Jordan Dickerson, sophomore from Dorchester.
You can see the training staff for Fitchburg State, led by Todd Soulier, all checking on him, making sure he's okay.
He's sitting up now. Looks like they're going to be able to get him up soon. While we have a moment, we want to thank the fantastic crew who make this and every broadcast possible here on FATV. Our director today is Jared Roberts. Travis Falk is doing audio and graphics for us. Kevin Newey operating the replay.
And then,
actually, excuse me, we apologize. That was Francisco Andino who was shaken up. So Andino is being looked at. Good to see him getting off the field under his own power.
As for the camera operators, Todd Govan, Moritz Vetter, Alyssa Fields, and Andrew By. For Vetter and By, this is their first shoot here with FATV.
That's right. Alyssa's running camera. It's her second time, and she's basically the veteran. So, you know, no pressure or anything. First and 10 Falcons on their own 26-yard line. Fake the pitch, hand it off to Palazze. Try to mix it up a little bit, still not much doing. Ultimately, Dan, that play is still a run straight up the middle, and the run straight up the middle is not really working.
Yeah, Framingham is well prepared for those runs up the middle, and maybe occasionally you get a run for 4 or 5 yards, but more commonly you're getting runs for 1 or 2, or in this case, -1.
The loss of a yard there, it'll be second and 11. Sims is the deep back. Aguirre in motion. Sims gets the carry. And he runs straight up the middle and does not get much of anything in particular. Framingham State actually came out of the pile with the football, but I believe it was after Sims was down. The referee is not too happy with the way one of the Rams came out of there, just kind of tossed the ball up in the air. We'll take a look at it again.
So Sims making his way to the right side, you can see.
Yeah, that is just not a fair matchup. That such an enormous size disparity on the defensive line.
I can tell you too, on that last play, if you had an all 22, it would not be showing a whole lot of the field. Everyone was sort of all in a very small box.
Now on third down, Haskins straight drop, throws over the middle, that's caught. That'll be a Falcon first down. Catch is made by Tim O'Neill. He gets out to about the 45-yard line.
Nice reception. No change of movement. That's a Pittsburgh first down.
O'Neal's fourth catch of the season, the senior from Ashby. Those are former North Middlesex Patriots hooking up for the reception there. And a good catch for O'Neal, who found himself open there. And a bit of a seatbelt tackle there for the Rams from Momo Nazaire.
Dan, I mentioned the size mismatch presented when Jamal Williams is on the field. You know, big number 52, the defensive tackle. He was not present on that snap. Falcon offensive line was able to give Haskins time to throw, and he delivered a strike to O'Neal. Now on first down, handoff goes to Frank Sims. He's got something.
4-yard
carry for him up to midfield. Represents an above average result for that handoff.
Combined for the Framingham hit. Second and six.
Sims will be now, I think, 8-for-20 on the ground today. Something about that. And as I mentioned, you know, a lot of the times you'll get one or two. Here's one of those occasional ones where you'll get close to five. I feel, you know, if you try to run that same exact play again, you're not going to get the same results.
I would think not. But really, just, you know, looking at Williams, at Lenz Pierre, Framingham State just has so much more size in their defensive line than Fitchburg does on the offensive line. Haskins fakes the pitch, rolls to his right, throws incomplete. I think Sims was the intended target. He was the closest Falcon to it. That time, Dan, he was under pressure pretty much from the word go.
He rolls out to the right side. Joshua Onajuego is right there, the senior from Wareham, a grizzled veteran of this Rams defense. You know, tried to do the play action, but there's not really anywhere to go. Has to throw it and ends up being hauled in by one of the Rams coaches. Made a nice catch on the sideline there.
Now it'll bring up third down and six for Fitchburg State. They may well be in four down territory if they get something positive here on third. But obviously they want it all. Haskins throws to the near side. That's incomplete. I think he was trying to hit Palazze and overthrew him. It's also possible that he was going for Dickerson and there was miscommunication on the route. Let's take a look at it again.
It's one or the other, but yeah, throw to Palazze, it's so farly overthrown there.
Tough to tell.
Regardless, not an ideal result, and from midfield on six to go. You're in that territory, there's a flag.
There is a flag thrown deep in the backfield.
Dead ball on sportsmanlike conduct. Coaching staff, Framingham State, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Wow, that's big.
That's a new one. Framingham State's coaching staff called for unsportsmanlike conduct. Dan, did you see anything happening there?
It may have been words, but my goodness, you know, we always say the coaches have to tell their players to stay disciplined, especially in a game as chippy as this. But if it's the coaches themselves,
if the coaches are not being disciplined, you know, who coaches the coachman, right? That's the question of who advises the mediocre ESPN anchor, right? Who coaches the coachman? Oh, jokes are always better when you have to explain them. First down handoff. Haskins keeps it himself, tries to get something going to the right side. Picks up a few yards.
Also, as a reminder, the athletic director of Framingham State happens to be the head coach as well.
Hey, how about that?
Johnson,
if it is one of the coaches that's misbehaving to give a free 15, he would be the person to yell at him.
He will have to take himself into a locked room and have a stern meeting with himself. Give him a real tongue lash.
Second and seven now.
Thank you. Haskins keeps it himself, rolls to the left, had the option, decides to keep it himself. And he plows forward.
Gain of about two.
Gained a couple. Take him out to the 30-yard line. It'll set up third down and five. So the Falcons are mixing it up a little bit more, Dan. And they're not just going with the straight handoff up the middle. This time they run the option. Haskins decides to keep it himself rather than pitch to Palazze. He gains, you know, 6 feet and a bruise for his trouble. So now third down and they're going to call it third and six for the Falcons. Aguirre in motion. I think he was heading toward the line at the snap. Haskins rolls right, plenty of time, finally gets rid of it, passes high, but it's caught. No, incomplete is the call. Palaszczuk came down with the football, but it must have touched field turf first. It's an incomplete pass. It'll bring up fourth down.
It's the only explanation I've got for you, because it looked like a completion from my vantage point.
Was a difficult catch for Palaszczuk. He had to go full extension for it. We'll take a look at this one. Haskins does a good job improvising, rolling to his right. There's a Falcon receiver who just gets body checked downfield. I'm sure that's fine. And oof. Maybe that ball hit the turf. Maybe. At that angle, that looked like a catch. Didn't that?
Yeah. I didn't see anything that made it look like it wasn't a catch.
Maybe as Palaszczuk was hitting the ground, maybe that ball, you know, hit the turf and was jostled a little bit, but that looked like a very good catch. Obviously, you know, Division III football, there's no instant replay or anything like that, but, and honestly, I don't think it was definitively a catch, but based on that replay that we saw, I think that was a catch.
That would be my feeling as well, but gotta move on from that. So 6:25 to go, first half, 14-0 Framingham out of town scoreboard. Bridgewater taking down Worcester by a score of 49-13.
Nice little squeaker there.
Meanwhile, Mass Maritime and UMass Dartmouth taking to the gridiron in Southeast Massachusetts. 12-3, the Corsairs of UMass Dartmouth up at the half. And minute 9 to go in the first half between Plymouth State and Westcon. And right now, Plymouth holds a 9-7 lead. The Panthers looking for their first win of the season. I wouldn't expect it against Westcon, but you know, right now the Panthers are sticking right in it.
Speaking of the Panthers, is this a good time for me to eat some crow about high school football?
Maybe a little bit. Well, 42-34, Fitchburg State, Fitchburg High, the Red Raiders.
Hey, we're even.
Fourth down.
Yep. Another one in for me, yep.
So it'll be fourth down and 6 now for the Falcons. They will go for it. Haskins back to pass, looking to his left, going long. Jump ball for Dickerson, incomplete, overthrown. Nobody was going to come down with that one.
Haskins pass falls incomplete.
It'll be a turnover on downs.
Dickerson, the intended receiver. Falcons turn it over on downs.
Wanted to go for the long haul.
Fans, you can beat the halftime rush.
For Dickerson on the near side, but yeah, just way too much air on that one.
University women's lacrosse team
had plenty of time to throw. The protection was good. The ball was overthrown.
Also, that was a hard jersey pull there by Dickerson on the Rams defender.
Could have been OPI, but you know. Does the uncatchable ball factor in on OPI? Because I know it's a thing on DPI.
Rams first and 10 from their own 31.
It wasn't going to matter anyway.
First and 10, Rams on their own 31. Pass to the near side is complete. Catch made by Bookie McBean. And he stepped out of bounds just across the 40-yard line.
Pass complete.
McBean was trying to bookie it down the near sideline, but he was in fact out of bounds. Can you tell that I'm having some fun with Mr. McBean's name?
This 160-foot wide field just doesn't feel like it's wide enough for these teams today.
Yeah.
Do they wish they were playing in Canada?
It's probably colder in Canada. You can see there McBean very clearly stepped out of bounds. But still picked up a first down. First and 10, Rams at their own 41. This time it's a handoff to McBean. He gets across the 45 and falls backward to the 46-yard line. Gain of 5 for him.
Rodney Bonhomme had the tackle for the Falcons.
Rod Bonhomme, the tackle for Fitchburg.
6 on the play, 2nd and 4.
Rams now up to 190 yards of offense on the day.
They've had really good blocking whenever they've done anything, Dan. Their quarterback has had all day to throw. They've had good running blocking. And there's a flag at the snap, probably a false start.
5-yard penalty, 2nd down.
Devon Ford guilty of the infraction. Have you false started a Ford lately? So that'll pretty much negate the gain on first down. We'll take a look at it again here. I mean, there were a number of guys who jumped a little bit early there. Could have gotten anyone.
Ford was split out there as the receiver on the near side, as he is again. Sort of cross-listed as a running back and wide receiver.
Pass on second down over the middle is complete. That's Manny Lara, the catch. Freshman from Lawrence.
Manny Lara with the Framingham.
And that's good for a Framingham first down. Again, the Rams are playing without the services of their primary receiver, E.J. Nichols, who was disqualified from this contest at the very end of the first quarter for throwing a punch at a Fitchburg player. It's never a wise thing to do for a number of reasons, because the man is wearing a helmet. You're just going to hurt your hand.
Why do people punch walls?
Hand off on first down. Walls can't punch back when they're mad at you, though.
No gain.
Bookie McBean unable to get anything going on first down.
Second and 10.
But Walls are 46-2 in fights.
At Ed 2?
If I can shoehorn a Tool reference in.
Hey, you know, that's fair. I make wrestling jokes, you make Tool jokes. We're both Tools when you think about it. Anyway, second down and 10 now for the Rams. Gofredo under pressure, rolls to his right, flag down. This is probably coming back if it's anything good for Framingham. It is, in fact, something bad for Framingham. That is a sack for Fitchburg State. Diamond Andrew combining with Eddie Guzman to make the hit. I would assume the Falcons will take the play.
Holding,
but
75
we'll
offense, that penalty be refused. Third down.
The hold is in fact brought back. So Josh Pace's record remains clean. But you can see right there, oh yeah, you've got a big handful of jersey and you drag the man to the ground so violently that you yourself fall with him. No, you can't do that, Josh. You cannot do that.
Also, I liked how the official's aim was so good on the flag throw it actually hit Pace. Just to remind himself of the sin he committed.
At least he didn't hit him in the eye. There was a player that happened to. Third down and 9 for Framingham State. Gofredo back to pass, pumps, now rolls to his left, runs into his own offensive lineman, gets into the second level. He's got a first down across the 35 and brought down at the Falcon 33-yard line. Looked for a second there, Dan, like Brian Lawton was going to break up that play and get himself a tackle. But Gofredo did a good job staying on his feet. You see right there, he runs right into his left guard. Lawton, bless his soul, still has no idea what's going on. Gofredo keeps it, gets into the second level, picks up a first down. Now back to live action. Bookie McBean the carry on first down. He spins out of a tackle across the 30 to the 29-yard line. And that's a gain of 4 for number 4.
And going back to that last play, we haven't seen Gofredo run the ball too much today, but he came into this game averaging 8 yards a carry, 22 carries for 174 yards. He could very much be a weapon on the ground as well. They just haven't gone in that direction. They haven't needed to.
And really, you know, at the college level, there are pretty much every quarterback can at least run the ball a little bit. There are very few statues playing college football. Second down, 6. Handoff goes to Ford as he's back in the backfield this time. Dances through tackles. He's got a first down and more. Mark him down at the 17-yard line. Stop the clock, move the chains. And the Rams are threatening to make this a 3-score game.
Devon Ford, who continues to be, you know, one of those really solid running backs, you know, averaging 6.6 yards a carry coming into that particular carry. Got a little more than 6.6 that time.
Just a little.
The Fitchburg 18.
Spotted that at the 18-yard line, which is where the Rams will have it, first and 10. They go gun empty 5 wide once again, but they don't like the layout. They'll call timeout. No, it's a timeout Fitchburg. Thought I saw the side judge indicate timeout against timeout called by Framingham, but regardless. Folks, Fitchburg Access Television is your local access TV station. If you live, work, go to school in, or are a member of a Fitchburg-based organization, you can become a member of FATV. Membership brings you many benefits and gives you access to all of FATV's equipment, including cameras, audio and lighting equipment, edit suites, studios, and so much more, including our newest addition, the FATV Podcast Suite. We offer technical training classes to teach you how to create your own program. You can reserve channel time to broadcast your program to the Fitchburg community and beyond. Visit FATV.org for more details and start producing your own show today. There you see a couple of our camera operators down there. That's Andrew and Alyssa. Thank you so much to them. They're doing fantastic work. You know, it's been something to watch, Dan, for me. You know, I've been lucky enough to be associated with FATV for going on 15 years now, and just seeing the way FATV has built a relationship with Fitchburg State University. There is, you know, every semester now there are kids taking classes, learning production, volunteering on events. It's really great to see, and it's really been something that I've been happy to watch evolve over the past decade and change. Back to live action here. First and 10 Rams. Under pressure is Gofredo. Gets rid of it to the left side. That pass is incomplete. Unable to hang on to it was Boogie McBean under the defensive assault of Joel Montero. It'll be second down and 10.
In the last minute, I've done a lot of nodding my head, but the folks at home cannot see me nodding my head to all of that. But
well, you know.
Just a quick throw to the left side. And McBean, you know, wrapped up there by Montero. Good defense.
Sometimes I do all the talking and all you can do is nod, right? He just nodded. I swear to God, he nodded. Second down, 10. Throw for the end zone. He's incomplete. Montero had a pick, but he couldn't bring it in. He is beside himself with frustration. He knows he should have had that one. Still good defense to get there.
Montero with the pass breakup. Third and 10.
We've talked about if you're going to throw it, throw it long. This time he threw it a little short, Dan.
Every chance the Falcons have to force a turnover feels like a golden opportunity, and so it's so frustrating for them when it goes by the wayside. The Falcons have only forced 3 turnovers all season long. And we're now going up on, you know, 3 whole games that they've yet to find the scoreboard. It was a pick 6 the last time that they scored, 3 games ago.
Third down and 10 now. Gofredo under pressure, throws to the right side. That pass is low. It's brought in. Are they going to call it a catch? Yes. Catch is made just about at the 1-yard line by Nick Gordon. They will spot it at the 1. Pretty much the exact position on the field where Framingham State started their first drive.
First and goal,
now they get ready to possibly walk into the end zone with less than 90 seconds to play here in the second quarter. Rams line up with a stack of receivers on the far side. They're just trying to bring the Fitchburg defenders away. It's a handoff
touchdown
up the middle and a touchdown, Devon Ford.
Devon Ford, 1-yard touchdown.
It's a really nicely designed play, Dan. They send 3 wide receivers out to the far side left just to reduce the number of bodies that are in the middle of the field. You know, Fitchburg has to defend those 3 guys. They have to send guys out to cover them. So with fewer bodies on the field, that creates more open space, letting Ford get in for the touchdown.
Just felt so inevitable, didn't it?
Farley's extra point attempt is up and good. 1:21 to play here in the second quarter. 21-0 at Framingham State. And this one is starting to look like a lot of people thought it was going to look when you saw the matchup.
I mean, that's one of those challenges. You know, last year, last time out when these 2 teams played each other, it was right here in Fitchburg. And it was 14-0 at halftime. And we were thinking, wow, Fitchburg is hanging in this game. They are sticking with them. Final score of that one was Fitchburg 7, Framingham 56.
Yep. I do remember someone who may or may not have been me saying, possibly earlier in this quarter, hey, it's only 7-0. It is no longer only 7-0. But, you know, there's still a second half to play. Fitchburg State is still going to get the ball to start the third quarter. They do have that going for them.
One of the positives, Henrik DeBoney just doing a run up there. You know, former Shrewsbury Colonial, originally from Brazil.
Framingham
doesn't have very many players from outside the New England area. Just glancing over the roster, maybe just a couple kids from New York State, you know, EJ Nichols from New Jersey, another player from Florida, good return there.
Palaszczuk takes it out to about the 29-yard line. Fitchburg only has 1 timeout left, 1:14 to play here in the second quarter. It would not stun me if we see Joe Haskins take a couple of knees. Actually,
the only reason that they wouldn't do that would be because Framingham still has all their timeouts.
Framingham still has all their timeouts, and also Joe Haskins is not on the field.
That would be the other problem.
Logan Wilson coming in at quarterback for Fitchburg State. Didn't see any injury-related reason for Haskins to be out of the game. Wilson under pressure, rolls to his left. Going to get brought down from behind. Yes, he is. He cannot get away from big number 91, Joshua Onujuego. And we get a timeout.
Onujuego had the hit for Framingham. Loss of three on the play, second and 13.
Pocket collapsed around Wilson. He knew he had to get out of there, but he couldn't get away from Onujuego.
And Framingham will call their first timeout. I believe they would like to have the ball back.
Well, you know, Fitchburg, as I said, is going to get it to, you know, start the third quarter. It's not a bad idea just to get some practice. You know, give your ball. Theoretically for Framingham, let's play this out here. If you assume Fitchburg runs it on second and third down and they don't get anything, right, that's going to burn 10 more seconds off the clock. You'll call your two timeouts. So they're going to be punting from about their 35-yard line, say. Your offense would probably then take over first and 10 at your own 30, 40, with what, 35, 40 seconds left in the game, right? Or in the half. That's a position where you may find yourself in a much more important situation later on in the season. You want to give your offense a chance to say, hey, here's the ball. At your own 35-yard line, you've got 35 seconds. Go put some points on the board. It's not a bad idea.
Yep. Never a bad time to practice, especially against a strong team, or in Framingham's case, maybe not so much. And that was something we were talking about pregame is, you know, last week they took on a winless Plymouth State team, the week before a winless Westfield State team. One of the things you've got to be wary about is you don't want to be trying to learn lessons against these teams that aren't necessarily going to work against a stronger opponent.
106 on the game clock.
Officials are going to put five more seconds on the clock, which will only add the Ram. Or only aid the Rams in their effort. But, you know, fair is fair.
Second and 12.
It'll be second down and 12 after Wilson was sacked. Wants to pass again, looks to his right. Dumps off to the far side. That's caught by O'Neal. Knees dragged out of bounds, short of the line to gain. It's a gain of about 10. It'll bring up third down and two.
From my personal experience, at least in watching these quarterbacks play, Wilson definitely has a little more of a reliable arm. Maybe not. And he's definitely mobile enough to create those openings. Is he more mobile than Haskins? I'm not 100% sure on that.
I would argue so, just based on what I've seen from him in these past couple of plays. But, you know, it's close. Third down, two for the Falcons. Wilson under center again. Quick drop, throws to the right. That pass is caught. That's going to be a Fitchburg first down. Gabe Mangrum the catch. He's brought down at about the 45-yard line.
Good for first down yardage.
So, you know, they open up the playbook a little bit more.
Ashley and Johnson combining for the Framingham hit.
Framingham State probably a little happier to concede these 5-9-yard gains, that sort of thing. Wilson under pressure again, throws to his left. That pass is incomplete. He was trying to find Matty Aguirre, almost did. Aguirre was well covered there by Dylan DeWolf as well as Momo Nazaire.
Matthew Aguirre, the intended receiver, second and 10.
It feels like Wilson's a little more comfortable throwing the football at the very least. And that's definitely helpful. In fact, you know, he had an incompletion against Dean. He completed both of the passes that he attempted against Bridgewater last week.
Yeah, just a little bit more poise as a passer. You know, again, this is in a two-minute drill, probably against a loose defense for Framingham State. Wilson under pressure again, rolls to his left, throws high and floating and incomplete. He was once again trying to find Aguirre out of the backfield.
Third and 10.
One thing you really notice, Dan, and this could just be the size of the Framingham State defensive line, Wilson is not a big fella. You know, 5'8", 170.
Yeah, I know they always say that they want a lot of size on quarterbacks, but yeah, Wilson does not bring a whole lot of size. You know, the sophomore from Woburn, he does have a fairly solid arm from what we're seeing.
Yeah, definitely capable of getting the ball at least in the area of where it needs to go. Faces a third down here, however. Back to pass. Steps up. Throws for the left. Double coverage and incomplete. He was trying to hit O'Neal. He very nearly hit Dylan DeWolf. Fortunately for him, he ultimately hit the turf. And now, Dan, after the three incompletions, Framingham State's going to get the ball back. They still have two timeouts.
They do, and to show that it wasn't injury-related why Wilson was in the game at quarterback during this last drive, Haskins has come in to punt.
Hard to blame the Falcons for trying to find something new. And we get whistles before the snap.
Second charge timeout.
So Framingham calls the timeout there, which had to be something they didn't like.
What in the world would be so bad on a 4th and 10 with the opposing team in an obvious punting formation that you would burn one of your two timeouts with 26 seconds left if you intend to try to score? What could possibly have been so bad?
Yeah.
Was there a fire? I don't see smoke. I don't see blood. I'm very confused.
It's not the time to take that time out.
You had 17 players on the field, it's still only a 5-yard penalty. Okay, well, the Rams took the timeout, so it'll make it that much more difficult if they choose to try to score with the remaining handful of seconds they will
really
have.
Think Fitchburg's trying to fake this.
I mean, if they're going to, this is a decent place to do it, but they will not.
They had nobody back there at all. They were 120% sure that Fitchburg was going to fake the punt.
Well, they were wrong. They had nobody back. They were coming at the play. They very nearly got to Haskins as he got that one away.
Yeah, they were selling out for either the punt block or the shutdown of the fake. And no, there was never a point where it looked like Fitchburg was going to fake it.
Not really, no.
Okay.
Well, you know, the Falcons faking the going with the onside kick to start the game, maybe it just got in their head. Maybe the Falcons are winning the mental battle, despite being, you know, down by 3 scores and very clearly outclassed right now.
Framingham's still going to try to score, though.
Yeah, why not? Gifredo under a lot of pressure. He'll finally take off and run with it. Dances out of bounds after a gain of about 7 and also running 15-ish seconds off the clock.
Leaves 4 seconds left. That last timeout's not really going to matter now.
That's true. Gifredo just kept waiting and waiting, trying to find something open downfield. Finally decided he had to get rid of it. Nearly lost the handle there. Good job by him getting the hand back on the ball. And now Framingham will concede to reality, and they'll take a knee and head for the locker room. But Dan, coming into this game, we thought, you know, the Rams might be the best team in the MASCAC. And if they are the best team in the MASCAC, Fitchburg is going to have their hands full. After 2 quarters of play, the Rams might be the best team in the MASCAC, and Fitchburg has their hands full. I think that's fair to say.
It's going as we expected. 253 yards offense for Framingham in the first half. Fitchburg with 64.
It's not good.
No, it's not.
No.
19 first downs for the Rams as well to 4 for Fitchburg.
Is that good? That doesn't sound good.
Fitchburg at least looked good on that last drive as they were starting to move the football. But there were some curious decisions in the last minute of that first half by Framingham.
One thing I will say, and this is a general positive for the way the second half of the second quarter went, the teams seem to have simmered down a little bit. Like, toward the end of that first quarter, especially with E.J. Nichols getting ejected for throwing a punch, it seemed like there might be, I remember literally saying the words, the game was in danger of getting out of hand. That aspect of it seems to have calmed down a little bit.
I think one of the wake-up call might have been that unsportsmanlike penalty against the Rams coaching staff. Might be one of those things that you're going to look like a massive hypocrite if you're trying to chew out your players for saying stupid things on the field in between the whistles. When you get caught for the same thing, you're And so from there on, you know, I think people realized, you know, they've got to cool it, because if they're going to call it sportsmanlike conduct on the coaching staff, I think they're going to have very strict tolerances for that from here on out. And it's up to the officiating to keep this game as clean as they can. 110 penalty yards between the two sides, 60 against Framingham, 50 against Fitchburg. And as we mentioned, that big ejection of their number one receiver in E.J. Nichols looming large for the Rams.
But Framingham State still able to put three touchdowns on the board. Fitchburg will get the ball to start the third quarter. And hey, stranger things have happened than a wildly outclassed Fitchburg State team bamboozling a highly ranked opponent in the second half here at Elliott Field. It's happened once before. Who knows? It might happen once again. We are going to take the halftime break here at Elliott Field. We'll be back in just a moment. It's College Football Saturday, and it's right here on FATV. We are back here at Elliott Field on FATV, College Football Saturday, as the Falcons of Fitchburg State play host to the Rams of Framingham State. I'm John Guggerty, joined, of course, by Dan Bolak. And Dan, we kind of expected that this one might get out of hand, and it's getting out of hand.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a challenging first half for the Falcons. Again, 0-5 coming in. They've now gone over 180 minutes without a score, and they've given up 122 points in a row.
Not good.
A lot of challenges. You know, the first half, we saw a lot of indiscipline really from both sides, but Framingham acquitted themselves to be the much better team.
A lot of undisciplined play, as you said, a lot of personal foul penalties in that first half, including, of course, the big play, the ejection of E.J. Nichols, the primary receiver for Framingham State University. We thought maybe that might slow the Rams' offense down, but it has not been the case. 21 points for them in the first half. As we take a look at some of the first half stats, Nicholas Gofredo, 13 out of 21 passing, 172 yards, a touchdown for him. Gofredo also 4 carries for 11 yards. He does have a long of 14. He's been sacked a couple of times. You know, college football. Devon Ford and Marcus Bookie McBean Jr. have been the primary rushing attack for Framingham State. Ford, 7 carries, 45 yards, and 2 touchdowns. McBean, 6 for 25. And no scores yet for him. But hey, it's only the first half.
And meanwhile, for the Falcons, you know, Joe Haskins was 1 of 7 through the air for 21 yards. He found Tim O'Neill for a big catch. Logan Wilson, 2 of 5. He was a little more comfortable throwing the football. Frank Sims, leading runner, 8 carries for 19 yards. O'Neill has 2 catches for 31. But yeah, there are those challenges.
We are just about ready to start the third quarter of action here from Elliott Field. We'll take you down to the field. Dan and I will get back behind the table, and we'll be with you momentarily. It's Falcon football here on FATV. Rams ready to kick it away here. They lay the boom as the ball goes flying through the air, finally taken in at about the 2-yard line by Dickerson. He jumps out of one tackle, spins to about the 20-yard line. Not too much doing for him. Dickerson with a pretty good return of the kick.
We've mentioned that there have been a lot of challenges with the Falcons this season, basically trying to rebuild this program from scratch. But the kick and punt returning has been on point. That's been one of the positives that the Falcons have had going for them.
Fitchburg State will come back out first and 10 at about their own 23-yard line. I believe that is Joe Haskins back in at quarterback for Fitchburg. So maybe the Falcons just went with something a little bit different for a play, for a series rather, went with Logan Wilson. But now Haskins is back as the signal caller. Hand off goes to the left side. Frank Sims the carry. Doesn't get much. We've heard that 85, 90 times this season for the Falcons.
Russell Yair with the Framingham stop.
And one of those challenging things for the Falcons out of the flex bone is just trying to make those runs up the middle work. But as we've mentioned, the depth has really been suffering lately for the green and gold, and they already have a rather immature line in regards to experience.
Second down and 7 after the 3-yard gain. Haskins keeps it himself to the left side and does not get much. Looked like he maybe had second thoughts about the decision to go far out to the outside. Tried to cut it back up the middle. Wasn't really anything there for him. The officials will call it no gain, and it'll be third down and 7.
Third and 7.
A little bit surprised, Dan, to see Haskins back in at quarterback. You know, Wilson was by no means lighting the world on fire, but he did seem like he had the Falcon offense moving at least a little bit at the end of that first half. But Scott Sperone decides to go back to his senior quarterback, Haskins.
One of the things is, you know, got to try to respect the pass with Wilson in the contest.
Haskins rolling out far to his right on third down. This pass is almost intercepted. Actually, I believe they are going to say, yes, it was picked off. Intercepted by the Rams to Shea Johnson Jr. with the pick.
With the pick for Framingham State.
Dan, you mentioned that Framingham State has a very young team. Shea Johnson Jr. is a freshman, and he makes the sliding interception there. You can see that is definitely a catch, and that's a pick.
His second interception of the season, the freshman from Windsor, Connecticut. And so the first drive of the second half for the Falcons ends that way, and it's going to be a very short field. Just 27 yards from goal are the Rams looking for their fourth score of the day.
Wonderful work, by the way, from the end zone camera. You see the shot there. Andrew By did a great job. Yeah, you like to shout out the FATV crew sometimes. First down carry goes to Devon Ford running to the right. There are flags down, so I think this one will be coming back.
There were two flags thrown at the exact same time right on the snap from two different sides of the field, essentially.
Probably somebody was lined up wrong then. Going to go ahead and say.
Legal formation on the offense. Five players in the backfield. That penalty's declined. Second down.
So Framingham State had one too many men in the backfield. Didn't have as many guys up on the line as they should have. But the play didn't get much, so Fitchburg will take the run for no gain rather than
second
a five-yard penalty. Hard to see much of it, much of anything there right at the snap, you know. Could have just been a lineman was a step too far back or something like that.
And we're a bit on the off angle as well, so it can be a little challenging seeing that line of scrimmage from the other 25, if you will.
You know what would be really great is if there was some sort of contraption that we could put our camera operators in like a little box and then lift them up, perhaps via some sort of scissor mechanism, high above Elliott Field so that we could get a more elevated view. That might be helpful. I don't know. It's something to think about.
We need to reinvent one of those.
Yeah, well.
Or we have to invent a very long wheelchair ramp.
Second down run, get about three. On third down, coming off the left side and right into the arms of a Falcon. They brought the rush from the exact right place. Bookie McBean had absolutely nothing going for him. You'll see right here, he runs right into Andrew Winningham. There's nothing he can do to get away from him. Winningham came from the defensive right side, did a really good job on the blitz that time. He was unblocked, and he wrapped up McBean. Of course, now being fourth down at about the 23-yard line, the Rams will still go for it. Goffredo back to pass, throws to his right. That pass is caught by Ford. He's close to the first down yardage. I think he had it and then came back. They're going
to
give him forward progress to about the 12-yard line, and that'll be good for a Framingham first down. Take a look at this one again, Dan.
Goffredo, of course, has that time to throw, and Ford gets himself open. As you can see, Sebastian Burmester just trying to wrap him up at the end. Tried to, you know, he's dropping back a bit as a linebacker trying to make that coverage work.
Now on first down, they go for the end zone. That pass is incomplete. They were trying to find Ford. He already has one touchdown catch. It was a beautiful 30-yard strike, the only touchdown pass by Goffredo. Of course, Ford also has two on the ground. Really, Dan, in the absence of E.J. Nichols, it's been a lot of Devon Ford. Although Ford will now, is he checking out? Yes, he's checking out. Thought maybe he was lining up as a split end, but no, he's just going to head to the sideline. Bookie McBean will be in the backfield for the Rams. Second down, 10. It's a handoff to McBean. Bounces to the right side. And Dr. Robotnik's mean McBean machine picks up about 6 yards there. It'll be third down.
Bonhomme had the hit for Fitchburg.
Of course, with
Sega Genesis jokes,
man. I never had one. But, you know, with Nichols out of the contest, the Rams have had to mix it up a little bit. You know, their bread and butter receiver not available now, so they've got to try to find different personnel to whom to distribute the ball to. But of course, in the backfield, McBean and Ford will do them just fine.
McBean takes it up the middle on third down here. Looks like he's about 3 yards short. given that Framingham went for it on fourth down just a moment ago. I would be stunned if they don't go here.
Sebastian Burmester had the hit for Pittsburgh.
Now we get whistles after the play. McBean very slow to get up. You can see him hobbling toward the back of your screen there. But he is heading off under his own power. Always good to see. He's a junior from Norwood. One of the few upperclassmen on this Ram team. And Framingham State has been a powerful force in the MASCAC for almost as long as there's been a MASCAC. That ball actually came out after the play. I think McBean's knee was already down, but Framingham State fell on it regardless.
There was really a time, I'd say, in the 2000s in which the Rams were about as bad as Fitchburg is now, but obviously they've built themselves into quite a dynasty in the 2010s. If you want football dominance in the MASCAC, you go right to Framingham.
Fourth down and five. Gofredo throws for the end zone. That pass is incomplete. The Fitchburg defense holds strong. They get a stop.
Manny Lara, the intended
Dan, is that the first time today that Framingham State has had the ball and not scored other than right at the end of the first half?
That's a good question.
No, they had that one bad punt. I remember that bad punt.
Yes. So.
But a rare stop there. Fitchburg State's defense holds strong on fourth down. The offense will get the ball, albeit inside their own 10-yard line. But hey, they'd rather have the ball inside their 10 than put up another touchdown for Framingham State. I think you'll take that every single day.
Falcons, first and 10 from their own 10-yard line.
First and 10 for Fitchburg. Bad snap. Haskins tried to fall on it.
Go on the exchange.
And he did. So it goes from bad to worse for Fitchburg's offense. This time they can't even get the snap away.
Snap was low. It looked like it hit the outside of his hands. And by the time he's got that corralled, there's three Rams there pushing him backwards.
We mentioned injuries to the Falcon offensive line. That does include their starting center, Frank Opoku. Now on second down, Frank Sims doesn't get much.
Short gain.
Opoku, the sophomore starting center for Fitchburg, is out of action today. We saw him on crutches before the game.
Third and 10.
So it goes down to Cam Lalonde, who has to do the snapping at center for the Falcons, and on the two deep that we got, there were a couple of blank spots on the line, which shows how much of a challenge the Falcons have had with the O-line this season.
Third down and 10. Everybody stopped on the hard count. And Palaszczuk even froze in the backfield as if to say, wait, they didn't blow the whistle? Okay. Haskins calling signals. Under pressure, rolls to his right, throws to his right. That pass is incomplete.
Haskins
believe
pass,
he was trying to hit Jordan Dickerson.
Receiver, fourth down.
Good defense there by Tashay Johnson Jr. Already had one interception today.
You can see Haskins immediately under pressure. I don't think we've said out loud what his completion percentage is on the season. It's not good.
Haskins to punt it away.
The big challenge has just been he doesn't have time in the pocket. He's sort of set up to fail with how little time he gets to try to compose himself and set up a pass.
Speaking of set up to fail, he'll punt this one out of his own end zone. Does get it away, bounces at the 35, picked up at about the 45-yard line and brought down after not much there. Kelvin Davila is not having a good day in the return game, Dan. He keeps finding himself going backwards, being spun down.
He's not had a lot of good fortune with dealing with Joe Haskins' punts off the field turf.
This time he was brought down almost immediately by D. Jones. But still, the Rams will take over inside Falcon territory. That's what happens when you're punting from your own end zone. Even a good kick barely gets out to midfield. This one sets up Framingham State, first and 10 at the Falcon 45. Devon Ford in the backfield next to Nicholas Gofredo, the quarterback. Gofredo, quick pass to the right side, is incomplete. Picked the absolute worst place to hit his receiver, right in the hands. Kareem Coleman couldn't bring that one in.
Look how effortless this is. He catches it, grasps it in his arms and grasps it in his hands and throws all in one motion. It's great poise there by the junior quarterback, but yeah, hit Coleman right in the hands.
It's a beautifully designed play against loose off coverage, this quick hitch out to the far side. By the time the ball gets to the quarterback in the shotgun, the receiver's already run his route, just couldn't hit it. Now Gofredo wants it all, jump ball in the end zone, tipped and picked off, intercepted by the Falcons. This one is in the arms of Marcus Moss. And that's another turnover forced by the Fitchburg D. They got the turnover on downs on the last possession. Now it's a tip ball and an interception in the end zone. We've seen Framingham State try that deep ball a number of times, Dan. They hit one of them for the touchdown to Ford. This time, however, Gofredo did not hit his man. He underthrew his man. Ball goes up in the air. Ball winds up in the arms of a Falcon.
It was Montero tips that up in the air as they wanted Devon Ford, and Marcus Moss is the happiest man on the field. He's come away with that interception. As I've mentioned, it's like those chances don't come too often, those golden opportunities to take away the ball there on an interception or a fumble. The Falcons happy to take that, their third interception of the season.
Haskins throws to the left on first down. That's incomplete. Think he wanted Dickerson.
Haskins pass falls incomplete.
Rams are not terribly happy with themselves on the defensive side of the ball. Momo Nazaire thinks he had a chance to intercept that one. We'll take a look at it again.
So Haskins immediately dropping back. A bit of a wobbling throw. And Nazaire, yeah, immediately has his hands on his head as the ball is flying by him. He knows he should have had that one.
He was the closest guy to it. Now second down and 10 after the incomplete pass. This time they'll try the pitch to Aguirre on the near side. Tries to turn the corner. Got back to the line of scrimmage, but not much there.
The ball carrier.
So they're trying to get to the flanks. We haven't seen too many plays out that far today.
That
time, see Nick Ashley wearing number 0 on the defense for the Rams, the one who's able to hold Aguirre to, well, I would have said 0, but they gave him 3.
You know, Fitchburg State has tried to pound the ball up the middle again and again and again, and it really hasn't worked out for them. Trying to get out wide, try the flanks now here in the third quarter. Little bit of success there, but it is still 3rd and 7.
Falcons 2 for 11 on third down today.
Haskins wants to throw to the near side right. That's incomplete. He was looking for Dickerson. Had Johnson
Dickerson
all over him. No flags come in, however. The officials say that coverage was just fine. And to be fair, it looked pretty fine.
Looked like a lot of arm wrestling there. That's what I thought I saw.
Pass was a little bit high too. Dickerson went up for it, but it was still over his head.
It's going to be challenging either way.
Punting unit out for Fitchburg.
So after the interception, Fitchburg goes 3 and out again. Hopefully they'll get a little bit better field position after this punt, maybe even get the Rams back in their own territory. That would be nifty. Haskins with a low end-over-end kick, taken in by Davila right at midfield, but this time he takes it on the run. The ball's on the turf. It is picked up by the Falcons, up along the far sideline, jumps around the tackle, and is brought down at the 30-yard line. Dan, I was just about to say that for once, things went right for Calvin Davila, and then they went horribly, horribly wrong.
He did the right thing in trying to play that on the air because he's tried to play that on the hop twice and it went really badly for him. He plays it in the air, he does the right thing there, and then it goes horribly wrong for him. Torian Wise takes the loose ball after it's ripped out there. I think it was Mangrum.
That was Gabe Mangrum.
Stripped it away.
Mangrum made no pretense of going for the tackle. He was going right for the ball and he knocked it loose. Torian Wise Jr. picked it up on the run, takes it into Ram territory all the way to the 31-yard line. Fitchburg State has not scored here at Elliott Field since 2019. They have a great chance to do so now. Haskins play action on first down. I think he wanted it all, but the pocket collapsed around him, and he's brought down for a sack and a loss of 2. I think, Dan, the Falcons were going for the dagger there. They wanted to go play action and go to the end zone. good coverage downfield, no protection from the offensive line, and Haskins goes down.
They've gone so long without a touchdown here at Elliott Field. They've gone so long without a touchdown in this regular season. They're closing in on 190 minutes, essentially. We're not already there.
The last time the Falcons scored, it was a pick six that put them up 38-35-7 over Worcester State. They have not scored since then. Aguirre the carry on second down. Got back to the line of scrimmage, not much more than that.
I would like to see on third down a pass, personally. And on fourth down a pass, too. I don't care how many yards you have to gain. Just throw it through the air if you can.
I think, obviously, this is going to be four down territory for the Falcons, but yeah. If you've got a five-yard quick out or something, just make it a more manageable fourth down. I think this is the time for that. But right now it is third and 10 for the Falcons at the Ram 31-yard line. Haskins straight drop, throws to the left, dumped off for Palazze. Catch is made, but he is tackled pretty much immediately by Cully Curran, the junior from Arlington.
Short loss on the play, tackled by Cully.
Palazze lost a yard. It'll bring up fourth and 11. So they do go through the air, Dan, but they go very short, and Curran is all over Palazze. Nothing he could do after he made the catch.
Summed it right up there. I wanted to see the pass. I saw the pass, but yeah.
Think you're going to see the pass again here on fourth. Fourth down and 11. Palazze goes in motion. Now he's going to line back up that second tight end position here in the flex bone. Falcons have two receivers to the near side. Haskins is under pressure immediately. Got to get rid of it. They're going to call that an incomplete pass. Joe Haskins was swarmed, and Joe Haskins is hurt. He is down. He took a big hit as he was getting rid of that. Just no protection at all on fourth down. Framingham State knew that the Falcons were going to go to the air. Joe Haskins, you can see him there grabbing at his right leg. Dan, he had no chance on that fourth down play.
All I could see through my binoculars, Nick Ashley and Cole Moretti just blasting through the line. Zero resistance whatsoever. Never a chance. So even when the Falcons, you know, they get that huge break there with the fumble recovery, and it all turns to naught again.
They just bust through from every angle, and then as Haskins is going down, I mean, he's lucky. I think he's lucky that they're playing on field turf here, Dan, because that looked pretty bad. It looked for a second like it was going to be a lot worse. So obviously we will keep an eye on Joe Haskins. Concern for him. He's back up on his feet, fortunately actually putting some weight on that right leg. So that's good to see.
Walking off under his own power. This is the second straight week that he's needed some help on the field.
Scary moment here at Elliott Field. Joe Haskins just swarmed by three different stampeding Rams coming through the line on that fourth down. He will head to the sideline. Framingham State takes over on downs. They'll have it again, first and 10 at their 31-yard line.
32.
So ultimately, the fumble on the punt return doesn't hurt them too much. Just costs a little bit of field position. Ford the carry here on first down. Breaks out a one tackle. Gets out to about the 35-yard line. Dan, I have a question for you.
Okay.
Did I see a flash as in a camera flash, or was there distant lightning a moment ago? Is that a camera flash?
I would hope it's a camera flash.
Okay.
If the officials thought that was a lightning flash, that game would come to a stop immediately.
Okay.
And then we'd have to sit around for half an hour.
That would be bad. I don't think anybody wants that. I want to call a football game for the next half hour. I don't know about you. You want to call a football game for the next half hour?
Yeah, I want to call a football game next half hour.
Okay. Let's call one now. Second down pass to the far side is complete. That is going to be
Devon Ford with the pass reception.
I thought that was Manny Lara, the catch. It's announced as Devon Ford. No, I think it was Lara. We'll take a look at it again. How many twos are on this man's jersey? I think it's just one. Yeah, there's just one two there. That's Manny Lara, the catch.
He's got those TV numbers that help out, too.
They do. How about that? Hey, we've already subtly thrown shade at Fitchburg State University once today. Can we do it again? Yeah, we'll do it again. Put some TV numbers on your jerseys, guys. It helps. Pass to the near side on first down is complete. Rams are across midfield into Falcon territory.
We call them TV numbers because us TV folk love reading them.
That's true. Isaiah Hanks with the catch for the Rams. If we're going to nitpick, they're pretty small TV numbers. But they're fine. You know, it's black text on a white background. That's pretty much as good as you're going to get. Yeah.
With a simple block font, they're quite readable.
They're fine. Rams are into Falcon territory. Play action fake pass to the near side is complete. This is Devon Ford, the catch. He runs out of one tackle and is driven out of bounds after another.
Devon Ford.
Looks like they're going to mark him inside the 30, probably at about the 25-yard line. Framingham State's offense has looked a little bit shaky on their last couple of possessions. They might be coming out saying, hey, we're still really good.
You know, there's probably a thought in them that's thinking that, you know, there's 19 minutes to go in this football game and we're only up 21-0.
It kind of does feel like only, right? You know, especially the last two possessions, the turnover on downs, the pick in the end zone. Now, Bookie McBean, the ball carrier on first down. He looked like he was going to be swarmed right at the line of scrimmage. Instead, he bounces it out to the outside, and McBean picks up a good run. I think they're going to give him a first down.
Close to first down yardage.
He got a lot of yardage on that one and does get the first down. You know, he was looking to go up the middle. He stopped because he saw there was no hole in the line. Didn't see anywhere to go. So just takes a brief moment, goes out to the far side, to his left side, to the near side, where he does see an opening on the flank. And ultimately, it's Montero who has to push him out of bounds. The only thing stopping him from the end zone.
Now we get whistles and flags at the snap.
False start. 75 offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Josh Pace once again having his name called. And, you know, if there is, there are many weaknesses in our game. We are mortal humans. We are fallible people. One of the things we don't do enough is call out the offensive line when they do a good thing. We've called Josh Pace's name twice today, so he's done two bad things. And that right there, that's a pretty obvious bad thing.
Pace, graduate of St. Peter Marion, who's now merged and become St. Paul with holy name, is on this play.
I mean, St. Paul is a pretty holy name, not going to lie.
It is.
McBean got the carry. Not quite back to the original line of scrimmage. Mike Brown, the tackle for Fitchburg State. This time just a straight, you know, halfback dive right up the middle. Not much doing there.
McBean, 11 carries on the day for a little over 40 yards.
All day for Gofredo to throw. He goes for McBean in the end zone. Juggling, he came down with it. That is a catch. Touchdown, Framingham State. And actually, I apologize, that is Nick Gordon, the touchdown catch.
20-yard touchdown reception.
A 20-yard pitch and catch.
Gofredo
to Gordon. The sophomore from Franklin finds the end zone.
Gordon gets his first touchdown catch of the season. You know, just battling there with Gary Spears. You know, ultimately, Gordon, with a lot of hands in his face, able to pull that in.
Extra point attempt is up and good. So with 2:29 to play here in the third quarter of action, Framingham State has extended their lead, and 28-0 feels, you know, perhaps for them a little bit more justified. You know, the last two or three possessions, the Rams had a bit of trouble. They turned it over on downs. They threw a pick in the end zone. They lost a fumble on a punt return. So Framingham State was feeling like, hey, maybe we're leaving some points on the board here. They didn't leave any points anywhere.
Not that time. While we have a moment, I want to remind you that all FATV remote productions are underwritten by Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise.
You see them there on your screen. Special thanks to all of our underwriting partners. And obviously, if you are a local business owner or just a person with a whole lot of money to blow on a local access TV station, we're not terribly proud, go to FATV.org, figure out how to contact us. It's very easy. And hey, you know, you can get me and Dan to say your name, as well as many other perks and benefits and thank yous from FATV. Enrique DeBoni will kick it away. Never seen a football quite that diagonal on a kickoff as it is finally brought down inside the 10-yard line, running parallel to the goal line, breaking through tackles is Dickerson. He gets across the 20.
Jordan Dickerson with a nice kickoff return.
Looked for a moment like he was going to break something truly big, but the Rams swarmed and contained him. And ultimately, it'll be first and 10 Fitchburg State at the 20-yard line.
That's a tremendous weapon just for the fact that's a perfect kickoff. That's just perfectly executed because it's gone to about the 2-yard line, so it forces you to return it, essentially, you know, unless you want to do the fair catch that you have the entitlement to do in college football. And then Dickerson has to work so hard just to get 18 yards out of it because it's been in the air for so long that the return crew has had the chance to get there, the coverage and all that. Haskins is in the game, so it's good to see that he is still fit to continue in this contest. As Frank Sims was never really tackled, but his forward progress had been stopped.
Very good. To be honest, Dan, I am stunned that Joe Haskins is back in this game. He got very lucky with the way his legs were positioned on that fourth down hit. But you see there, Sims' momentum was clearly stopped. So, correct call to blow the whistle, even if the Falcons were not terribly happy with it. It'll be second down and 10 now for Fitchburg State. Haskins keeps it himself, tries to make something happen to the near side.
Joe Haskins.
Gets a few yards. Give him two. It'll be third and 8.
Had the Framingham stop.
Ashley had the hit for Framingham State.
Third and 6.
We'll take a look at it again.
This time faking the handoff to Sims, and Haskins trying to find the hole on the right side. There's a bit of space to work with, but that's the linebacker's job, to come in there and shut down the play, and that's exactly what they did.
Haskins did a good job. He executed the play fake well enough to get one Ram to bite, but he wasn't able to break three for a noticeable gain. It'll be third and 6 now. This time they do the handoff up the middle. Sims with some second effort running. He's going to get close to the line to gain. They're going to move the chains. That's a Fitchburg first down.
Six moves the chains, a Fitchburg first down.
As he was low to the ground, just kept churning and was able to get the ball across the 30-yard line.
Falcons first and 10.
To get that first down.
I think the Rams were maybe thinking Haskins was going to keep it himself. So much yardage to gain. You don't expect that Fitchburg's going to run it up the middle, but they do there. And they get the first down. First down handoff goes straight up the middle. Not much doing there. Dan, is that Juzari Saleem? Yeah. Juzari Saleem on the carry.
An angle's deceiving because that got 10 yards.
And another Fitchburg first down.
You always do a double take when you see number 96 is the ball carrier. This time Saleem got good initial blocking and then great second effort running. Does pick up the first down. It'll be first and 10 Falcons at their own 41 on what will probably be the final play of the third quarter. Handoff goes to the near side. Rams are trying to strip the ball. They think it came loose. Hold on here. We'll take a look at it. They did. Framingham State takes the ball away. Saleem did not hang on to it. Nick Ashley comes out of the pile with the ball. And now it's the Rams' turn to force a turnover. They'll get the ball inside Fitchburg territory. And that's a killer.
As it looks like they're finally making progress. As the ball goes up so high, a bit exposed. And the Rams just, they see it, they pounce on it, they steal it away. And Nick Ashley, I think, was the one who came up with it.
Ashley was the one who came up with it. Tashay Johnson Jr. was the one who stripped it away. Johnson already has an interception, now add a forced fumble to his ledger. Play fake, Gofredo under pressure, rolls to his right, throws to his right, passes low and incomplete. Looked like he was trying to hit, oh goodness, Devon White.
That's the end of the third period.
Wasn't he an outfielder, Devon White?
just like Nick Gordon is a shortstop.
Exactly. But that is the final play of the third quarter here at Elliott Field. Framingham State leading this one by a score of 28-0. Dan, we thought coming in that, you know, any given Saturday, anything can happen, but the most likely result was that Framingham State was going to put a whooping on the Falcons, and Framingham State is kind of putting a whooping on the Falcons, I'm not going to lie.
I mean, yeah, from that perspective, 28-0. I've said this a bunch of times around that I could look at the D3 scoreboard right now and I could find you a lot larger blowouts than this.
That's true. That's true. It could always be worse. That is a positive thing.
North Central, number one team in the nation, taking down Carthage 64-13. There's an example.
How about Mount Union, number four in the nation? They lead Wilmington 55-0 at the start of the fourth quarter. So, you know, it could always be worse.
It's very much the case here in this region. At least Fitchburg's defense is good enough. Ooh, Benedictine 54-40 over Lakeland. That's a very interesting game.
Well, Dan, how about you call the fourth quarter of action here?
Let's have that. As this one goes up the middle, and that's some great running there by the Rams.
Bookie McBean
Jr.
Nice game on the play.
With a heck of a run to get it to the 25-yard line.
We've seen a lot of McBean out of the running game, Dan. Devon Ford has been lined up as a receiver a lot, especially since the ejection of E.J. Nichols. You know, we speculated that maybe that would slow Framingham down. They have not cared at all. You know, E.J. Nichols is a really good player, but he is not their entire offense.
Not necessarily a linchpin as they go for that home run pass, but nobody catching that one.
That was a little bit overthrown, intended for Ford. And I got to say, Dan, Tom Kelly is clearly an adherent of the strategy, you know, once or twice a quarter, just chuck it deep, see what happens.
Kelly, one of the, you know, long-tenured coaches in the MASCAC, 17 years as the head coach of this Rams side, has been the athletic director at Framingham since 1994. You know, a lot of respect. Before the game, you know, I saw a lot of Falcons coaches happy to talk with him, and such a friendly, affable guy, too. As Gofredo trying to run with it this time, he gets the 21-yard line.
Gofredo.
It's a gain of a few yards.
Gain of four on the play.
He was spun down hard by Mike Brown. He was turned around basically 360 degrees by Brown right at the end of this play. Take a look at it again.
It's probably only the second or third time that Gofredo has tried to intentionally run with the football today. You know, he's been sacked once or twice. Gofredo dropping back, looking, rolls to his right. Manette chasing after him, throws over the middle. It's going to be caught by McBean. Past the 15-yard line, that's going to be another first down for the Rams. First down number 27 on the day.
McBean does an incredible job here, Dan, just awesome hanging on to this catch. He's going to catch the ball right here and take not one but two big hits, and he still manages to hang on to the football. I guess you could say that he's one tough bookie.
Ooh.
That was worth it.
11 yards from goal are the Rams. Gofredo floats it up there on the left side, but again, you know, throw it where Kareem Coleman can only catch it, but if he caught it, then they wouldn't have given him the points for that.
Yeah, no, he would have been closer to the track than the actual end zone, I think.
You can see it was D. Jones lining up there with the coverage.
And again, Dan, they really have not thrown at D. Jones that much.
They may have beaten him once or twice today, but a lot of the time, D. Jones has done a great job in shutting things down.
I think we're going to get another false start on the Rams here.
False start, offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
That feels like, what, four or five times Framingham State's been called for a false start? And you can see right there, it's, you know, it's the slot receiver Ford. I think it's the right tackle as well. It's both of the tackles.
Second and 15.
Everybody just starting a little too early there.
Framingham State very eager to get their plays underway.
That didn't work out at all. So it was McBean trying to go up the middle, and Falcons had that one read.
Had a Fitchburg stop, tackle for a loss.
Yeah, that was going absolutely nowhere. McBean runs right into the arms of Cam Monette. Monette was busting through the blocking of Josh Pace. Just blew through that left tackle, got into the backfield, and he was able to bring down McBean.
Third and 17, and the thing to beware is that 15 or so yard completion, as it'll be caught on the near side. And there's that 15 or so yard completion.
And a flag.
Manny Lara made the catch.
Manny Lara had the reception. There is a flag down.
It's a flag down after the play. One of the Falcon defenders is absolutely gobsmacked. Marcus Moss has no idea what he's going to be called for.
Dead ball, personal foul, late hit out of bounds. Number 7 of the defense, half the distance to the goal, first down.
They're going to call that on D. Jones. Dan, is D. Jones even on the field?
Wasn't on that side of the field.
Take a look at it again. I'm pretty sure that this is actually against Marcus Moss, number 5. But we'll take a look at it here.
Rams first and goal.
So are they calling that the late hit out of bounds?
Yeah.
I thought that was the hit that knocked him out of bounds.
Guess just because he stepped on the sideline at that moment. First down, run up the middle. McBean not going to be able to get to the end zone on that one.
This has been a very chippy, aggressive game, and I can understand why the officials would be inclined to throw a flag quickly rather than let something fester. I cannot believe that penalty.
Multiple Falcon tacklers. Second and goal.
It would have turned what was probably going to be a fourth down play into a fresh set of downs for the Rams. Now the Falcons have to stop them 3 more times. Got them the first time. They're going to stop them the second time, too.
It was a flag thrown right at the snap. Could be an illegal formation on the Rams. We've seen that before. But it could also be a Falcon offside. We'll have to see what the call is. Framingham State is applauding.
Upside, 98 defense. After this is to the goal, replay second down.
Justin Stanford lining up a bit too close. Wipes out the unsuccessful run and gives the Rams a couple of yards in compensation.
And you saw there on the replay, Stanford tried to jump the snap, maybe lost his balance, fell into the neutral zone, and he was lined up there at the snap. So that turned into a free play for Framingham State, and it wound up being half the distance to the goal.
Now Gaffredo's going to try to take it on the ground himself to the end zone. Touchdown, Framingham.
3 yard touchdown.
Third touchdown run on the ground for Nicholas Gaffredo this season. And it's 34-0 to the Rams.
Those quarterback runs right at the goal line are so hard to contain. For a defense, you're focusing so hard on the guy in the backfield. This time Gaffredo keeps it himself off of play action. He just dives forward, follows the wonderful tackle, follows the blocking rather, of his offensive line, and he gets in.
Extra point by Farley is perfect as usual. 21 for 21 this season, the freshman from Middleborough. The thought is, you know, I watched the, you know, we saw Thomas Fay last week. We see Matthew Farley this week. They're both perfect in extra points this season. And you think, why can't we have a kicker like that? Except this season we actually do in Matt Gimble, who's perfect 5 for 5.
We have two kickers like that, you know?
Yeah, Linnea DeKeel,
she was, what, 6 out of 7 on extra points
in 19? 7 for 8 last season. You know, missed the first one, got all the other ones. It's like the Falcons have had reliable kickers. We just don't get a chance to see them.
Yeah. It's, The Falcons had one game where everything was clicking. The defense put points on the board. The offense got in the end zone. They scored 35 points against Worcester State. They still lost that game, mind you, but they did score those 35 points. Aside from that game, Fitchburg State's entire offense this entire season, 6 points.
While we have a moment, out of town scoreboard update. UMass Dartmouth 26, Mass Maritime 10. They're in the fourth quarter in that one. And there is one less winless team in the MASCAC. Plymouth State has stunned Westcon 16-13.
That is a huge upset. Westcon will be here on November 6th, our next telecast from Elliott Field. Plymouth State, of course, are the Falcons' next opponents.
And obviously, Plymouth State's pretty happy that they're going to be going back home to Panther Field up in Plymouth, New Hampshire, with a win on their ledger.
It's a flag on the return. Palaszczuk did not even get across the 20-yard line.
I really do think they they should start considering the fair catches. I mean, I understand that you're conceding the possibility of a big run back. But with the ball going that high in the air off the leg of Henrique Deboni, I just... You know what I'm saying, right?
Yeah. No, it's very difficult to return a kick. It's such a high kick, too, off of Deboni. It's not just, it's a low line drive kick that happens to go deep. These are high, booming kicks. They give the Rams plenty of time to get downfield and swarm the return man before he gets anything going there. There's a hold also on the Falcons. We couldn't see it there. But Logan Wilson is back in at quarterback for Fitchburg State, by the way.
On first down, a run up the middle. They started this drive from their own 7-yard line. And Trey Lowry,
the ball carrier.
Trey Lowry gets the carry on first down.
Short game.
Falcons now in that position of the game where they're going to try, I think, some different personnel.
We saw Haskins pulled at the end of the first half for Wilson. Wilson didn't look too bad running the offense. But Haskins is back on the sideline, and he's wearing the snazzy blue penny, I think. Does that mean he's just done?
Probably. Second and 9. It'll be another handoff. On the first contact, thought Lowry's going to be wrapped up, but he kept his feet going and ultimately was able to get to the 10 before his progress was stopped.
Nick Ashley on the hit. Gain of 2 on the play.
Give Lowry a couple.
Just the run up the middle and,
Third and 7.
Some pushing, shoving, yelling afterwards.
Lowry's a freshman. He comes to us from Pflugerville, Texas. Dan, I have a question for you.
And that would be, what's a Pflugerville?
No, where's a Pflugerville? You're the guy with the laptop. Where's Pflugerville, Texas?
That's a question for Wikipedia.
You're the guy with the laptop.
I am the guy with the laptop. Tiago Palma's got the catch for a first down. I'm focused on that right now.
Okay, fine. I will pull out my phone. You call the football game. We need to find out where Pflugerville, Texas is.
Good for first down yardage.
What a great catch there by Palma on the throw to the right side. Found the opening. And to the 20-yard line, the Falcons are able to move the chains. Something they've not been able to do too much today. Throw over the middle, nearly hauled in. But Jordan Dickerson just could not come up with the football.
Pass ball's incomplete. Dickerson, the intended receiver.
Falcons trying to get over 100 yards of total offense on the day. They're currently on 95.
I have performed an investigative journalism. Pflugerville, which is actually spelled with a silent P, is a city in Travis County with a population 61,737. It is a suburb of Austin.
I could have told you at least from the Travis County part, yeah. Suburb of Austin. The Circuit of the Americas out in Austin. As on this down, up the middle for about 3 or 4 yards, goes Trey Lowry.
Lowry. Gain of 3.
You look
graduate of Bishop Stang High School. Hendrickson High School.
3rd and 7.
Yeah, Bishop Stang is
Jacob Figueredo, who's right above him on the roster.
Falcons with 77 players on the roster, 35 from Massachusetts. And Lowry is one of 3 Texans. As Wilson immediately under pressure, never a ghost of a chance of getting that off. And it's going to be a sack
Wilson
for Jarrell Boyce. The junior from Dorchester, very pleased with that.
Jarrell Boyce.
I think that's the first time we've called Boyce's name today.
That hit for Framingham, 4th down.
Breaks through his tackle. We see Lowry there trying to block him, but Boyce just would not be denied. Now Joe Haskins will come back out to punt.
He did have that little penny on, but I guess he had to take it off for that. Look a little weird.
Yeah. They're the green and gold, not the green and gold and one guy wears blue.
Really high snap, able to get it off. And now they'll try Devon Ford to take the punt return this time. As he reverses direction, stays on his feet, and gets to the 45-yard line. I think one of it is, you know, you don't want to use Ford so much in the punt return game because you want to be able to rely on someone else and make sure, you know, when you start the drive that Ford's not already winded. But Kelvin Davila has had a bad day, and at this point they just go back to Ford, who has more returns on the season than him coming into today.
Ford tried to make something happen there. He ultimately does gain yardage on the return. I want to get back, though, Dan, to the play made by Haskins, just getting that kick away. It was a very high snap. He actually had to leave his feet, go elevated, just to bring it in and get it away. Now, I'm a little surprised that the Framingham State still has their starting offense on the field here. Thought it might be time to go a little bit deeper in the depth chart there, guys.
First down, Gofredo all day to throw, going for the home run pass. And Marcus Moss had the best look of all, which means that was not going to go well for Framingham. Just ends up being an incompletion.
Holding, 72 offense. That penalty, replay first down.
And even if it had been caught by a Ram, it wouldn't have counted anyway.
Part of the reason he had all day to throw is that Tegan Andre was playing fast and loose with the rules regarding blocking. So it'll be a 10-yard penalty, back the Rams up. We'll take a look here. See if we can spot the hold. I think it's going to be just to the right of the screen there. But Framingham State decided, you know, five touchdowns is not enough. Let's go for a sixth.
I bet you they feel like they need to win against Fitchburg by more than Bridgewater did last week. Gofredo again with lots of time. Eventually will have to tuck and run, and now he'll just slide down there.
There is another flag down.
May have also been willing to go to the ground because he knew that this couldn't have worked out anyway.
Holding, 78 offense, 10-yard penalty, replay first down.
Now Bryant Bowman can be the guilty party, another minus 10. First and Natick. Shout out Tim Foley. Natick's his hometown.
Hey, how about that? You see Bowman lined up in the left tackle position. That's been a position of need for Framingham all day. Josh Pace was guilty of a number of penalties out of that same spot earlier. They tried Bowman now, and he's not doing any better.
So first and 30 to go. And ultimately, McBean's going to get a good chunk of that back. Bring it back to the Framingham 45-yard line.
Gain of almost 10 on the draw. Maybe a little bit more than that. You know, Fitchburg played very loose coverage, obviously expecting the Rams to go deep through the air again. So the draw is a well-designed and well-called play there. Makes it second down and 19.
McBean up to 69 yards, nice day for him. Throw is going to be caught.
That is a fantastic sliding catch, winding up on his helmet. And it's coming back.
For the third time this drive. Holding against Framingham. The O-line has forgotten the rule book.
Yeah, no, it's stop grabbing them there. That was a great catch by Gordon that unfortunately is erased.
If you're an O-lineman and you're grabbing handfuls of jersey, you are not doing your job properly.
It's on Bowman again up at the top of the screen. I think maybe it was at his initial block. He was, you know, grabbing the left shoulder pad of his defender. Not one of the more obvious holding calls, but you know, what's that old saying? You can call holding on any play.
Right now, Framingham is committing holding on every play. Gofredo.
There's a flag down.
Long pass downfield, and it's caught there by Gordon.
There's a flag down.
And let's see if this one counts.
It won't. Wait for this. This is on 75. It's very funny.
Holding, 75 offense, 10-yard penalty.
So,
second down.
So after Bowman committed multiple consecutive holding penalties, I mentioned that they had him in the game in place of Josh Pace, who had himself been having a rather poor game. They brought Pace back in the game so as to punish Bowman for not being good at football, and then Pace committed a hold, which negated a huge almost touchdown pass. You see there, 75, that is, the one before I said was not a very obvious hold. That is a very obvious hold.
It's second in Westboro. I've got to go further down Route 9 now.
Yes.
It's become a comedy of errors on this drive.
If they do one more, could it be 2nd in West Springfield? Are we going in that direction, or are we going east down Route 9?
I was going west. It'll get there eventually. Framingham has to call timeout because the play clock ran out. 5:23 to go, fourth quarter. It's 35-0 Rams.
Hey, you know, they're still up 35-0. We can have some fun laughing at them as they completely forget how to play football for a minute or two here.
It's like four holding penalties on the same drive. 2nd and 39 is always inherently funny.
That's, yeah.
A reward for the fans who've stuck it out here, and we thank everyone for having joined us here today, whether you're here at Elliott Field or you are watching at home on FATV, Comcast 9, Verizon 36, on any of our wonderful apps, on Android, on Apple.
One of the many holding penalties here. This is the last one. I'm sorry, go ahead. Plug the apps.
And also available on Amazon Fire, on your Apple TV, or on your Roku devices.
That's right. Look for the FATV app. We are streaming all over the place, and of course also on FATV.org.
We're probably also simulcasting on the Falcon Sports Network today. I forgot to double check if we are or not.
I would hope so. You know, Dan, I know we've seen longer to goes. I remember like a 4th and 40. I don't remember 2nd and 39.
It'd just be a dump off pass here for Devon Ford, who just moving back and forth, zigzagging. He's still on his feet. Is able to get it to the Framingham 46-yard line. There's no yellow hankies this time, right?
Nope.
Nice gain on the play.
You know, Dan, it is going to be 3rd and 16, and that represents a miracle for Framingham State. That was an incredible play by Ford. You know, they did the draw on first down. That worked out well. This time they go with a screen to Ford. He's just dancing over tacklers, trying to make guys miss, keep the play alive. And he gets a good chunk of yardage.
They brought it back to 3rd and Natick. And on the near side,
they got Natick.
They got it.
Hold it.
Nope. No, they didn't.
We play 3rd down.
Back to 3rd in Westboro
for the 5th time.
You know, Dan, before the game, in a moment that I think might have been an accidental hot mic, I asked you if I've been relying more on shtick this season. Framingham State is relying on shtick right now. This is very fun. I enjoy this.
They get called for holding again. We're going to be corpsing. They're going to have to send for the man. They might have to send for the men. My goodness. 3rd and Westboro.
I didn't know I could make botchamania jokes. Oh, this greatly expands my playbook.
Gaffredo, he's got all day. There's another flag.
I can't. Please be holding. Please be exactly holding. Don't be an ineligible man downfield. Don't be
holding. 53 offense. Penalties declined. It'll be 4th down.
It's holding.
Because the pass was incomplete, they're not even going to charge this one.
Tevin Cadet is the guilty party. You know, there are still like 40 names on Framingham's roster that we haven't called if they just want to cycle in new offensive linemen. You know, can Marquise Dos Santos commit a hold? Can we get Christopher Connolly on the field to hold somebody? I mean, you've got two Rams holding the same guy on that play. Yo, who else is here? Can we get Barry Nangle III? He's listed as an offensive lineman, Dan. He could come in and hold somebody.
And Henry Naboni gets a good punt off. Falcons will play poison with that. And now back there, Malachi Granberry and Devon Ford exchanging words.
You know what Ford was doing with Granberry's jersey, don't you, Dan?
Which would be?
He was holding it.
Yes, he was.
He was also, you know, pushing and shoving him, and maybe should have been called for unsportsmanlike conduct, but he was, in fact, holding his jersey. All right, we should you know, straighten our collars, button ourselves up. Everybody take a sip of water, calm down. Let's call the rest of this football game like distinguished gentlemen, darn it.
That may have been the most hilarious drive I've ever called in my life. 6 times Framingham got caught holding.
six times. That's two-thirds of an end Rudy. Six times.
I cannot remember the last time I'd keeled over laughing on the air.
Nope.
3:52 to go in this game, 35-0 Framingham in front. Wilson with the handoff on first down to the right side. I'd say it was Lowry with the carry that time.
William Lowry.
Number 49 it was for a gain of about three.
At the tackle for Framingham. Gain of three.
It makes you forget that Fitchburg still has that goose egg on the board.
Well, you know.
They've had that goose egg on the board for about 14 quarters of football now. They've been outscored 136-0 in that stretch.
I don't think that's good.
But, you know, sometimes it's those little things that you take a moment and you can just look back and things.
Lowry, gain of almost four on the play.
Lowry on the right side gets a good gain on second down. Brings up a third and manageable.
We mentioned Fitchburg State will be at Plymouth State next week. After that, they will travel to UMass Dartmouth before coming back here for WestCon on Saturday, the 6th of November. Two more games here at Elliott Field before the end of the season.
It'll be the last two games of the season for the Falcons. They'll have Westfield the week after to close out the campaign. Wilson going to Tika himself, go for the line. If he's not there, he's very close to it.
Logan Wilson.
And he is there.
I think they've got it. Yeah, that's a first down.
Good for first down yardage.
Now they fake the handoff up the middle. Wilson keeps it himself, rolls out to the right. Needed the 35, and he got exactly the 35. It's not much, and it's not fancy, but 'tis enough. 'Twill serve.
Rolling under 2 minutes and 15 seconds to go in this game. The Rams on their way to their 16th straight MASCAC victory. As on the option, Wilson's going to take it up the left side for about another 3 yards.
Wilson, the ball carrier.
Had Mack Kimball running behind him. Don't know if he saw him, don't know if he was thinking about the pitch there. But we might see that in the future. Yeah, he never takes a look out to his left, but he did have Kimball there. You know, give the Falcons a few more weeks to get used to this this offensive scheme. We might see him run the triple option by the time they come back. Who knows?
Man, I wish they could just give it to Kimball in a flea flicker and have him throw deep downfield. On this one, though, you can see that Framingham had a handful of the jersey. And that time you can hold the jersey. Jarrell Boyce gets his second sack.
You see right there, Wilson indicating that's my bad. And you see right there, he did a play-action fake to nobody. So play fakes to nobody typically don't work. I think I remember Tom Brady did that for the Patriots like once. He did a play fake to nobody and then threw a touchdown or something. But usually play fakes to nobody are indicative of poor play design or perhaps bad execution.
So Wilson dropping back, loses the football as he's hit. Battle for it on the ground. And Fitchburg did recover it.
Wilson never saw the rush coming. He didn't hear the footsteps. It's gonna come from the left side of the screen, pretty much unblocked. Just plowing right into him is Najair Montero. It's a huge hit suffered by Wilson. It'll bring up fourth down. And actually, Dan, something mildly interesting. TJ Farr is on to kick it away for the Falcons.
The interesting thing is the Falcons don't even have to punt it if they don't want to.
That's also true.
Yep.
Play clock is not running. There are 15 seconds left. I think we're just about done here. The Falcons are quite done.
You don't feel like running a fake here down 35. You're too far away. It's like scoring will just have to wait for another week as time will run out and Framingham State take a 35-0 victory.
And it's Pittsburgh State University.
We thought coming into this one, Dan, that Framingham State may well run away with this and hide with it, and that's pretty much what happened. You know, looked a little bit shaky for the Rams there at a couple of times. Obviously, there was that rather hilarious final possession, which we will be able to carry with us for a while. But for the most part, Framingham State is a very, very good team. Fitchburg State is a team that is almost essentially starting from scratch here with the football program. And when a team like that meets a team like that, you kind of expect something akin to 35-0. And this one wound up being 35-0.
Frankly, I expect something rather akin to 65-0.
Also possible.
But 35, I mean, I'll take 35 in comparison.
I mean, honestly, this may surprise you folks. I am a bit of an optimist. If you had offered me 35-0 at the start of the game, I would not have taken it. I would have taken my chances. But hey, you know, sometimes you get 35-0.
So final stats, Framingham 416 yards of offense, Fitchburg 105 yards of offense. I'd like to also point out the penalties, 8 for 69. It was super chippy early in the game. That eventually settled down, and eventually Framingham got into the habit of committing holding penalties. They finished with 12 penalties for 120 yards, Fitchburg 8 for 69.
And honestly, Daniel, something we've talked about, don't point at me, I'm not going to say nice. You already said nice for 69.
Yep.
But something that I think is worth mentioning for Framingham State and an area of improvement for them are those penalties. You mentioned they just went through a part of their schedule where they had three winless teams in a row. And you know what? Credit to the Rams. They handled their business. They beat Westfield State 41-6. They beat Plymouth State 33-0. They beat Fitchburg State 35-0. Good for you guys. You did your job. Now you got to go play WestCon. And WestCon's, you know, good. I don't think you can get away with committing 12 penalties for 120 yards against a team that is, you know, good.
And then,
so,
and
something to work on.
And with WestCon having just lost to Plymouth, and what they're going to feel is demoralizing, embarrassing fashion, they're going to have a chip on their shoulders next week at Bowditch Field in Framingham. Going over the stats again, Nick Gifredo, 21-37, 282 yards, two touchdowns and an interception. Interesting, we never saw the reserve quarterbacks for the Rams. They kept Gifredo in the entire game. I mean, yeah, we just didn't see them go down the depth chart.
They really didn't. They kept with Gifredo. They kept with Devon Ford. You know, finished 10 carries, 50 yards for him. Bookie McBean, 15 carries, 69 yards. Ford, of course, had the three touchdowns, one through the air and the two on the ground.
Yep, Ford finished with six catches for 92. Elijah Nichols, EJ Nichols, four for 64, all in the first quarter before he was told he wasn't allowed to play football anymore today.
Well, he had a hand in that decision, so to speak.
Yes, he did. Isaiah Hanks, four for 38. Nick Gordon, 2 for 37. He had a couple of good catches that didn't count, but one that did count for a touchdown. And meanwhile, going over to the Falcons, Logan Wilson, 3 of 7 for 28. Joe Haskins, 2 of 13 for 20 and a pick. Frank Sims, 12 for 30 on the ground. Trey Lowry, 5 for 13. Jazari Salim, 2 for 12, but lost that fumble. And it, through the air, Tim O'Neill, 2 for 31. Tiago Palma, Gabe Mangrum, and Ben Palaszczuk each with catches for the Falcons, who fall to 0-6 on the campaign, and they go up to Plymouth State, who are obviously going to have a lot of momentum because they are playing with a win from today on their trip down to Danbury, Connecticut.
Absolutely, and as we said, after the Plymouth State game, Fitchburg will play UMass Dartmouth, and then they will return here to Elliott Field November the 6th for a matchup against WestCon, Western Connecticut, and November 13th will be our final game of the season here at Elliott Field against Westfield State. Before we get out of here, folks, we want to thank all of the corporations who make this and every production possible here on FATV. Our remote productions are underwritten by Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance, Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise. Dan, why don't we thank our excellent crew as well?
All right. Also want to remind you today's crew, Jared Roberts was our director, Travis Falk doing audio and graphics, Kevin Newey on replay, Todd Govan, Moritz Vetter from the soccer team, continuing that long line of athletes doing camera work for us, Alyssa Fields and Andrew Bai doing the camera work. Also want to remind you our next telecast of local live football will be next week. We're going to be at Bulldog Field at the Fitchburg-Westminster line. It's going to be Monty Tech hosting Worcester Tech, and what should be an interesting football game. And then we'll be back at historic Crocker Field on the 22nd, as it'll be homecoming for the Red Raiders. They'll be taking on the Wolves of Neshoba.
Plenty of fantastic football action still to come here on FATV. Folks, thank you so much for being here. For Diesel Dan Bolak and the entire FATV crew, I'm John Gugarty saying thank you for being here. We'll see you next time right here on FATV.